transformation is the ego's plan of salvation. I go to church. I go to Catholic church, but I'm not a Catholic. You get the communion wafer, and the communion wafer is supposed to have some transforming capability, transformational, transmutational capability. But what is real doesn't need any transformation whatsoever, and what is not real can never be transformed into the real. And yet the entire belief system of the ego, the belief system that we are following, have been following for so long, is at its root, it believes in transformation, that nothing can be transformed into to more than everything. And we're trying to find the catalytic agent for that to happen, which is why we continue to search instead of just to choose unconditional love. Very few have chosen unconditional love. It's right there, it's very simple, and yet we are still searching. We think, well, you know, why choose unconditional love now when we're so close to getting that catalytic agent which will transmutate the hypothetical into the real? And all this hypothetical of death, of destruction, etc., will be real. It'll become a real power. And we'll be able to go to the Prime Creator and say, Prime Creator, you need to change reality for us. If not, we're going to obliterate reality. We have this power to obliterate, to negate, unlimited power to negate reality. And we think we're almost there. And again, we believe it's a fait accompli, that it's a certainty that we will succeed. That is the belief system that we have been operating under for so long. Now, what we do is we do not attack belief systems so much. We don't attack it. We point it out and clarify what is it that it believes, but we don't attack it. What we do is we say, okay, that's a belief system. Catholic Church, for instance, believes that by taking the communion wafer, that it's literally has been transformed into the flesh and blood of Christ, and it is going to transform you, transmutate you. It is going to bring you to eternal life by taking the wafer there. They believe in that. It's a belief. So, okay, that's a belief. What we do is say, okay, what you need to do is take a look at another belief system, okay, and then compare the two belief systems. We're not trying to tear down a belief system. We're not trying to destroy a belief system or anything. We're saying, okay, this is what the belief system believes. And then here's another belief system, a different belief system, but you can choose that if you like. And this belief system has different beliefs. Does not believe in transmutation, transformation. Does not at all. And so you don't have to junk, you know, the belief system you have now. You don't have to throw it away. You can say, well, let me put it on the back burner. Let me look at this new belief system, this other belief system alternative. Let me see what that says and take a look at it. Take a good, clear look at it so you know exactly what the belief system is all about. And then you can say, okay, now which one is going to give me what I really want? Which one is going to truly reconcile me to truth and reality, eternal life, etc.? And which will not? You have to evaluate that way. When you have a choice, you don't feel so threatened. I don't feel threatened by looking at different, you know, belief systems and saying, which one do I want? Doesn't feel threatening at all. Whereas if you only have one belief system and you don't think there is any other, then everything you hear that doesn't align with it, you feel it's an attack on your belief system. And you get very upset and very defensive and very fearful. So instead of attacking a belief system, take a look at an alternative belief system and see what that has to say. Now, of course, it's going to be say what opposite of what you know, the other belief systems can be opposite. What I'm saying is opposite of the ego's belief system, the belief system in transmutation of the hypothetical. It's the opposite. It says, no, that can never happen. It's the opposite of saying that there's nothing that's impossible. No, this belief system says it's impossible to change reality. Even the Prime Creator can't change reality. It's impossible to transmutate a hypothetical into the real. That's impossible. Okay, it's impossible for time to circumvent endlessness. Lots of things are impossible. Lots of stuff's impossible, actually. The Prime Creator cannot change reality. Cannot. Endlessness cannot come to an end. Cannot. So there's lots of impossibility, and seeing that is very, very important. So you don't keep trying to accomplish the impossible, which is, by its very definition, a waste of time. So this belief system recognizes a waste of time. It recognizes, it sees it, and says, ah, that's a waste of time. I'm not going to do that. But it's fair that it looks at both belief systems and evaluates both of them and then says, ah, both of these can't be true. They cannot both be true. And then you're in a position of being able to choose one or the other, which is a great position to be in. As long as you don't evaluate the belief systems, you might fall for the old trick of saying, well, both can be true. I don't need to choose because maybe they're both true. Maybe. That's the voice of those who have been too lazy to examine both of them. If you examine the two different belief systems, the one coming from reality, the other coming from the hypothetical, you'll realize that they both can't be true. And so you can never say, well, maybe we can integrate them. Maybe they're both okay, both true. Not possible if you take a look at them. They're complete opposites. Each one cancels out the other. Each one denies the validity of the other. So you can see this, and the most important thing is to realize they both can't be true. So then you say, okay, next step is I need to decide which one is true. So the path that's successful, that works, is not a path of attack. It's a very considered, reasonable, fair examination of the two alternatives to belief systems there are, and to, in doing so, recognize, well, wait a minute, these can't both be true. If you see each one clearly, you know that they can't both be true. And that's a huge step, because then you vault yourself right into a position of, okay, let's choose one. Or let's choose what we really want. What will give me what I really want? And let's choose that. No attack, no attempt to tear things apart. Let's just decide, choose one or the other. We don't have to do anything to either belief system. Just let them be what they are. And just simply make a choice. That's all. Don't have to tear anything down. Leave existence exactly as it is. Leave only footprints here, as it were. Don't have to correct anything about that belief system, because we're not trying to correct it. We're not trying to fix it, make it anything it's not, change it. No, just simply see what it is. And then we say, okay, that I know now what that belief system is. And okay, fine, and I know what the other belief system is. And now I am in a position to make a decision. So again, don't spend your time trying to change the world or change anything. Spend your time trying to see what is there. What is actually there? Trying to change it is really a cover-up. It's essentially saying, oh my gosh, this belief system is so flawed, we better make some drastic changes to it, and let's put a fresh coat of paint on it and all this kind of stuff, and charge a mission to it and make it seem like it's very, very important, so important that we have to have all this rigmarole around it to hide the fact, to hide what it really is, to keep anyone from looking at what it really is. So many religions and spiritual movements and teachings, etc., are based on the beliefs, this particular belief system that's unexamined. That the religions are just like a front to keep you from actually examining the belief system that it's, that's hiding behind it. And, you're supposed to jump through all these hoops. And I look at people who've been members of a church for, their whole lives, members of a religion, members of a spiritual teaching, etc., etc., and they've never even taken the slightest look at any depth at all. They've simply utilized the trappings and all the means religions and teachings give them to obscure, to cover up, to not look, to be distracted, to claim, oh, look at this, very important, I need to look here, it's very important. Instead of looking at the belief system that's hiding behind it. So anybody who actually looks at the belief systems, compares the two belief systems, there's really only two belief systems. Either the impossible can be accomplished or cannot. Either God can change reality or God cannot change reality. Either we can become prime creator or we cannot. Either we can transmute the hypothetical into the real or we cannot. See, two different belief systems. It's either or. Either we can or we can't. Belief systems, one belief system is believes that we can. The other belief system says, no, we cannot. And so compare the two. And yet nobody, you know, we don't get down to the brass tacks. We don't get down to it because we're too busy jumping through hoops. We get all these teachings saying, well, you know, stand on your head for 10 years and then hold your arm up for another 20 and then go on for fasts and all this stuff. And by the time you do all that stuff, we'll see how you feel at that point. And by that point, you're old and tired and you just want to kind of hang out. It's no good. You can't waste your time that way. You cannot waste your time that way. You have to spend your time looking, comparing the two belief systems, seeing what is actually there, what they actually believe in. And this world is hell-bent on not doing that. It'll do anything but that. The world is willing to do anything. The world was willing to pave the entire planet rather than simply look at the two belief systems and compare the two and see what's really there and compare them. It's willing to do anything and everything other than that. Because that brings, what does that bring up? It brings up the issue of choice, choosing. And that's what this belief system existence is deadly afraid of, is choice. Choosing which belief system you want. Because actually the one that is being peddled here in existence, the belief that a hypothetical could be transmuted into reality, the belief that prime creator can change reality, you know, the belief that the impossible can be accomplished, the belief we can change reality, all these things, it's totally weak. It's easily seen through, you know. So it's a totally weak position. And in seeing that, you'll realize, oh, I don't want that. That's not what I really want. I want the other belief system. So this belief system, the false belief system, I call it, has to divert our attention from looking at it, to just maintain itself. The fact that it's maintained itself for so long means it's supremely successful at diverting our attention. And that's all it does. It just diverts our attention in some way. Every time we try to bring our attention and look at it, there's diversions crop up every time. I still get the diversions. I still get diverted. Having looked at it so many times and for so long, still the diversion is automatic. They just, you stop focusing on it, and before you know it, boom, you've just lost the trail seemingly completely. So we have this enormous machinery of diversion in this world that keep us from simply evaluating the two and which one do we really want, and then bringing up the issue of that we can choosing one or the other. Because the issue of choice is all important. Because ultimately, the way we really free ourselves from this miserable massacre of existence is that we choose a different idea. We choose a different causal agent. We don't change the effects of this idea that we chose before. We don't change those effects. We don't struggle with those effects. They are what they are. They're death. They're impermanence. They're constant energy constantly transforming, constant transformation taking place, constant instability, constant change, constant dying, aging, cycling through, heating up, cooling down, all of this stuff, constantly, never ending treadmill. We know what it is. We just look at it and see what it is and say, okay, that's what it is. Okay? And then look at the alternative. What is the alternative offering? And just by doing that, you're right upon the freedom. Freedom is right in front of you. It's very simple. And yet somehow, throughout history, almost everyone has been diverted from doing this. Almost everyone spends their entire life never even looking at in this direction whatsoever. Almost everyone. And such lives are literally, they're wasted. And what we do is we've invented, imagined, and believed in all sorts of beliefs about how each life somehow adds to us, is building up something, that each life is extremely important, and we learn all these lessons and all this kind of stuff. It's all nonsense. It's a grand illusion. We can believe it. So since we believe it, we believe this is all happening. It's not really happening the way we believe at all. We're really just simply getting nowhere. We're simply wandering around aimlessly. If we don't look in the right direction and examine the two different belief systems and then realize we have a choice between the two. Which one is it? We can't have both. They're mutually exclusive. Spend our life that way, then we really have spent our life in the right way, used our time in the right way, and we've returned ourselves to the power of choice. I know Eckhart Tolle wrote a book called The Power of Now, but the real power is the power of choice. That is the real power. That is what you have to realize and recover and see, that you have a choice to make. If you don't compare these two belief systems, you won't realize you have a choice to make. So you won't even think about choice at all. You'll just rely on magic. You have to get to choice. And a life that doesn't get to that is a life that is simply wasted, spent, frittered away in distraction. And so these videos here, keep hammering away, keep going at this. Have to. What else is there to say? We have to get to that choice, and we have to keep working at it. We have to keep reminding ourselves. The distraction, again, we are so over-familiar with distraction that it happens, like, seems to be automatic here. Automatic. And therefore, we keep assuming that this is what we really want because it happens, seems to happen automatically. Is it? No, but it happens because we've overlearned it to such an extreme extent. And we're using our creativity to distract ourselves, that it seems spontaneous and automatic. But the purpose is to simply perpetuate this folly, this whim of trying to be prime creator. To buy time until we find some way to transmute the hypothetical into reality. We just keep buying time. It's all existence does. It buys time. It's the great time buyer. We don't need any time to choose. Do we really need time? You see one and the other and say, which one do I choose? Okay, I want this one. You don't need a lot of time for that. Choice can happen in a moment, in an instant. Choice itself doesn't require any time. Getting to the choice may require some time on our part. But the actual act of choosing is not reliant upon time or place or anything. We have that power. We have to see that as the fundamental power that we have as choice. What idea do we want to experience? And if we choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, a belief system arises from that. And if we decide we want to make a choice, another belief system arises from that. The desire for what we really want does give rise to a belief system. The desire not to change, try to change reality, gives rise to a belief system. Because it's really not a fully creative idea, the idea of not trying to change reality. We can't change reality, so why in reality, why would we ever choose such an idea? It's only because we chose the idea that we believe we could change reality, that we chose the idea of not trying to change reality. And then the belief system arises from that, that shows us why we believe it. Because we have a belief system that we can change reality, we need to to have another belief system. We're so used to belief systems, we can't just go cold turkey and ditch belief systems entirely. We can do it, but we're too scared to do that. So we need another belief system. We need to exchange belief systems. It's a very safe thing to do. Instead of just ditching all belief, just saying, okay, I don't need any belief anymore. Because in reality, there's no need for any belief. Everything is, always, endlessly is. Where is there any doubt? There's no doubt at all. But in this fantasy, this dream, this hypothetical scenario, it's full of doubt. So we need belief we need to believe in it. Believe we can succeed. Believe we can find a way, transmutation, all that. So we're so wrapped up in belief. We need to have a smooth transition out of that belief into another belief system. And there is another belief system that simply tells us that we cannot do the impossible. We cannot separate from reality. We cannot. Can't do the impossible. It's not possible. We cannot transmutate the hypothetical into the real. We cannot do that. We cannot change reality. Cannot do that. We can't change what we are either. So again, it's either or. Either we can or we can't. And that's what we have to decide. So our choosing rests upon deciding. And the belief systems merely are inform us like about our choice. They're advocates for the choice. One advocates that the choosing of trying to change reality was the right choice and will be successful. The other advocates the idea of choosing not to try and change reality is the right choice. And will be give us what we really want, because the other is impossible. So their advocacy, a powerful advocacy for choosing one idea or the other idea. And so as we listen to this advocacy, we then are brought to choice. We either choose to continue on with the hypothetical, or we choose to experience unconditional love, the overlay that is tremendously delightful, what we really want. We can choose that. Those are the choices. And belief systems, you know, guide us in that direction, or this direction, depending, you see. So we have to work within belief systems, which is why we still use words and concepts and talk about it. So we're talking about our faith, our belief. You know, there's a lot of faith, a lot of belief in transubstantiation, transmutation, all of this. A lot of faith and belief in it, that it's going to work. And then another belief system says, no, that is not how. What works is choosing a different causal agent. Okay, that's how it works. You don't have to transmute anything in existence. Existence is what it is. The hypothetical is a hypothetical. You don't need to change it. You just accept it as it is. It's a hypothetical. That's what it is. It does have isness. It is a hypothetical. Don't need to change it. You just need to say, okay, do I want to experience a hypothetical, which is merely a plausible experiencing, or do I want to experience unconditional love, and then realizing that will be easily translatable, not transmutational. You can't mutate it, but translatable, meaning smooth continuity back to the full reconciliation with reality, the way reality really is. Okay, just choose which one. Which one do I want? Power of choice. That's the ultimate power. Make that your, you know, focus, the power of choice. Because we've done everything possible to not be aware that we have the power of choice. Existence rests on a foundation of denial of the power of choice. That is the cornerstone of existence, denying. Saying the denial is so deep, no one even asks the question. We don't even consider it as something we even think about. We basically say we're here in existence, and that's it. This is reality. This is where we're at. This is our home. The question is insane. You know, there's no reason to question anything. Let's just accept it. Just adapt to it. That, of course, is trying to deny choice. Always. Reality doesn't deny choice at all. Always we're aware that we can choose different causative agents, different ideas. Ideas a causative agent, gives rise to effects, gives rise to experiencing. We are the spirit chooses ideas. That's what we do. So at all times, in reality, we're aware that we are the navigator, the chooser. And yet in existence, that's completely denied, forgotten, that we think that this we're supposed to make choices within the context of existence, within the context of a hypothetical. We think that's the only place where we have to exercise our choice. You know, where do I go on my vacation? That kind of thing. What kind of clothes do I buy? What channel am I going to watch? What game am I going to watch? You know, what time am I going to get up in the morning? All these choices we make, and that's all within this existence, within the hypothetical. That existence is just an imaginary, hypothetical scenario. So what kind of choices? It's a meaningless thing to say we have choices. Because we're not choosing a causal agent when we're just deciding, you know, where we're going to go on vacation. That's not choosing a causal agent. That's just saying, among these various effects, which set of effects do I want? Do I want to go to Hawaii or the Caribbean, you know, or Costa Rica or Alaska or wherever? Those are just a set of effects. You go to Alaska, you see the glaciers, you see the bay, you see the mountain, you see various stuff on your cruise to Alaska. Or if you go to Hawaii, you know, you're going to see the palm trees and the beaches and the ocean and all that, the plumerias, and it's a different set of effects there. So wherever you go in this world, you're choosing different sets of effects, but it has nothing to do with a causal agent. You're not even thinking about that at all. What causes all this to arise? What's the cause of it? Can I choose a different cause? Of course. Can I choose a new idea? Of course. That's never brought up here. And so just by omission, you know, errors of omission. If the greatest sin is the errors of omission, the ignorance is, you know, here's supposedly bliss. It's not. It's misery. Because the errors of omission is that we just omit focusing on our ability, our capacity to choose a different, you know, choose causal agents, ideas. Never, no one talks about that. I had to, you know, dedicate my life to digging into this and getting it out. Couldn't just find it, you know. It's not just, can't go down to the store and buy it, so to speak. Nobody wants to talk about it. But that's what has to be talked about. Has to be talked about. And our culture and the world just is, you know, dead set. Existence is dead set against any examination that has to do with causal agency. What existence says is, God made the universe, and that's it. Or, nothing made the universe, and that's it. Or, the universe simply made itself, and that's it. Boom. You know, it's, don't look any further. That's it. But nobody says, wait a minute. Or very few say, wait a minute. Maybe the universe arose from an idea that spirit chose. How about that possibility? It didn't arise from God. It didn't arise from nothing. It didn't arise from itself. It arose from an idea that spirit chose, the idea of wanting to be prime creator. How about that? See, boom. You're not going to hear that. Existence won't tell you that. Existence won't tell you where to look, how to get free from existence. It won't tell you that. Will not tell you it. So I didn't get this from existence at all. I got it from the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, divine reason, that which informs us about reality. I got it from there. Didn't get it from existence. If someone says that all they've ever learned came from nature, from existence, then it's for sure they don't know anything worth knowing. Because they don't know about what gave rise to all this. They don't know about we have the power of choice to choose a different scenario altogether, choose unconditional love. They don't realize that different causal agent, the idea of not trying to change reality. They don't know that we can choose that. Nature doesn't inform us of this, which is why I say nature is worthless, because only that which is worthwhile, which informs us of our options and our ability to choose a new causal agent, only that is worthwhile. Everything we do in nature is just building castles made of sand, which always melt into the sea eventually, which is a lyric from a Jimi Hendrix song. In this world, everything we do here, everything our play with existence, everything we play with, it melts into, is transformed energetically into other formats, always, ceaselessly, getting nowhere. And none of that will ever inform us correctly, never. That's why the transmission from the gurus, the great teachers, saints, sages, avatars, etc., are so important, because you can't get it. You can get it internally, and you can have it reinforced, but you're not going to get it from nature. You're not going to get it from anything externally in existence. Cannot tell you where to look. Cannot, will not. You remain totally ignorant if you don't get a hold of the truth, which comes from reality, from divinity, from the prime creator, transmitted here into this dream by various agencies, and you have to get a hold of that. It's an uncommon truth, not coming from existence, not coming from nature. You study nature, you're not going to find out anything of importance, really. Are you going to find out by studying nature that you can choose? You have the choice to choose something other than nature. You can choose unconditional love. Is that what nature is going to tell you? It will not. Absolutely will not. Nature is entirely an advocate for its cause. But because we believe that cause and effect can be separated, we assume that nature is some kind of free agent that can tell us anything it wants to. No. All effects witness to their cause. Nature witnesses to its cause, which is the attempt to manufacture a power that can destroy reality. And the belief that transmutation is possible, that some catalytic agent can transform the hypothetical into the real. There's all sorts of, so nature simply believes in all of this. And just continues on in that. You're going to get nothing from nature. What nature teaches us is how to waste our time. That's what it's, you know, perfect. It's the perfect teacher of that. If you want to waste your time, you know, you're in the right place as far as nature goes. You know, this is, it's great for that. If you want to continue to hold on to your belief system in accomplishing the impossible, this planet Earth is the great perfect place for that. And that's what most come here for, that purpose. It's like an ideal place to hold on to your insanity. Ideal place. It's like an insane asylum where there aren't really any therapists, and everyone's insane, and so everyone just sort of celebrates their insanity. Collective insanity, and reinforces it. And so if you want to hold on to your insanity, come to planet Earth. Ideal place for that. But of course, not everybody here wants to hold on to their insanity. So it's a tough road here, because of lack of reinforcement, because of familiarity with all sorts of you know, the belief system, familiar with the belief system, familiar with all the resistance, all the fears, everything that causes problem. You're familiar with it. That's a drag. Everyone in the world is again here to try and perfect their insanity. And that makes it tough. And again, nature will never tell you the truth. The insane will never tell you where to look. So where do you turn to get the right advice? Where do you look? You know, you have to find some source of truth, some source of inspiration that is actually true. And it's hard to find. It's hard to find in this world. But if you're willing to find it, you will find it. If you're a workaholic, if you're somebody who's determined, who says, I want to find out the truth about the situation I'm in. Is this true? Is all this death true? What is going on here? What's the truth? Then you can find it. You will find it. Depending on your determination, you will find it. Something. You will find something that will be helpful for you. And also you will have internal experiences that will be helpful for you. You'll get glimpses that will be helpful. But if you just go out in nature and just say, oh, I'm just going to enjoy nature, that's going to inspire me. Well, you know, it does to a limited extent. You see the feeling of freshness, of vitality, of all this kind of, you can get sort of a buzz off of nature that gives faint echoes of what you really want. But as far as informing you of your power of choice and decision and the belief system, the two different belief systems, all that, no, nature won't inform you of that at all. So you do have to put in the time where you're not really focusing on nature, where you're basically oblivious to it. I spend a lot of time that way. I spend a lot of time simply in a room. I actually had the windows all boarded up, covered. There was nothing external got into the room. It was like a cave, literally like a cave. And I just sat in the cave and contemplated, read, studied, contemplated constantly, year after year after year after year, every day. And really had no contact with nature. Didn't pay any attention to nature for a long time. Long, long, long time. You know, while the rest of the world was busy doing their hiking and their, you know, all the nature activities and going places, and I was in a cave, a suburban cave. All my time, I'd only come out of there just to go to the kitchen to get something to eat, then I go back in. That's it. And just full on focus on reason, clarification, which didn't need any help from nature at all. Did not need any interaction with nature at all. That's the way to really make tremendous progress. Because then you're not being distracted by nature, by any, you're not being distracted by other people either. I had no interaction with other people. Very rarely. After a while, I started going out once a day, a little excursion and then back, but, you know, limiting it. And actually, you know, seclusion can be extremely helpful, the most helpful thing, really. Because you begin to play with ideas, with belief systems, you begin to look at belief systems directly, instead of being distracted by something pretty, you know, in nature, something that's attractive in nature. That won't inform you about anything. The attractions we feel in nature are very diverse in many, many different ways. And yet none of those will inform us about what we need to be informed about. Again, at best, nature gives a faint, faint, faint echo of what we really want. We can get this very faint echo if we, you know, see something as just seems so attractive. We just think, ah, I just wish this were forever, you know, I just wish this would never change. You can get that faint, faint, faint reaction. But again, it is way too faint. I mean, you have people spend their lives that way and they still don't have a clue about the two belief systems and about what each one is believing and that you have the power of choice between the two of them. We can choose a new belief system. Not even a clue about it. That's standard. That's what happens. So if you happen to be lucky enough to find yourself in seclusion, you're very fortunate indeed. Not a, like a negative seclusion. You know, it's a seclusion for the point of studying, to focusing in the realm of belief and ideas, and seeing the dynamics of thought and all of that. You know, it's very important to do that. But most are not afforded that opportunity, which makes it extremely difficult. Used to be there was more opportunity in the world than there is now with the monastic ideal for everyone. The idea was those who were most gifted would have the opportunity for monasticism. And it was seen as the greatest opportunity, which it is, to spend a lifetime in contemplation. And after doing that, you're in a position of realizing you can choose, and therefore there is a way to get free of existence. Simply a simple choice is what does it. And you never regret spending that time clarifying all this, because you realize if you didn't spend that time clarifying all this, wow, you'd still be completely ignorant and totally stuck. But, you know, how's that monastic ideal playing out in today's world? It doesn't play out at all. You know, what? How many vocations are in Ireland right now? Ireland used to be the very home of vocations in the Catholic Church, and now what I heard, there was like only one in the whole of Ireland, like a few years ago or something. Just like one. that is so almost impossible to believe that. Really, it used to be every family would have someone who took a vocation. And now it was only one in all of Ireland? In our diocese, I'm not a Catholic, but I attend Catholic Church. They told us this year there's no vocations. No vocations. They're grabbing vocations mostly out of, like, you know, the Philippines and Vietnam and Africa, various African places. Not sure which countries there. You know, third world places where people are desperate for a better life, and they're getting vocations out of there. It's a way to a better life, and it most certainly is for them. But in the developed worlds, there's the vocations are like next to nothing. It's incredible. Because that is an opportunity. Vocations are opportunity, and again, you can choose a monastic vocation as well, a contemplative vocation, and there's all these, you know, universities set up to help with that. And but wow, it's just not happening anymore, which means the world thinks that it sees something more valuable, a more valuable way to spend your time, and there isn't really any more valuable way to spend your time. And it's not really boring. It's the most fascinating life of all. Because you literally are seeing into existence. Seeing all. Everything that's been obscured and hidden, you see it now. Finally, after, you know, so long of being in the dark, you finally are seeing all this stuff. And it's just incredible. You know, every day is like, wow, you can't wait to get up in the morning and have more insight. It's fabulous. Done rightly. Done with urgency. Today, the priest said that contemplation is the highest form of meditation, which is true. Which is true. The ability to contemplate, the ability to look at various beliefs and turn them this way, turn them that way, inquire. It's inquiry. Contemplation is really inquiry, which is what satsang, which is what the Eastern traditions say. Satsang is all important. Inquiry is the same. It's a contemplation, inquiry. It's really the same thing. to become aware of what we really believe in. What are we believing in? What's belief? What's the belief system? Becoming aware there's a belief system. There's all these defenses. There's all these tricks. Becoming aware of all of that and saying, wait a minute, what is the goal of all this? What is the purpose of it? Where did it come from? Getting answers to all these questions. I've had all my questions answered. I've seen the answers to all. That is the most exciting life of all, for sure. It is the most exciting. Of course, the world thinks it's the dullest life of all, because they don't see any, thrills of interacting with all the attractions of nature. All the culinary, attractions, all the fashion attractions, all the glamorous attractions, all the physical attractions, the emotional attractions, the attractions of, in every different way, everything, that the external world seems to give us, but it's all superficial. I went through a phase, I wanted to see what it was like of being a fashionista, and so I've been through that phase. I know what it's like. Wow, it's an addiction, it's a sickness. It's really something, you can get into being a fashionista, and it just becomes like any other addiction. It's horrible. You really think that every day you have to buy something different, and every single day you have to dress differently, and you're never dressed quite right. Never dressed quite right. And there's always someone who's dressed better. You're always looking for something better. You're always looking to try to put the right outfit together, and it becomes just like an obsession. Fashion can become very obsessional, extremely obsessional. As can any search, external search in existence, can become very obsessional. Meeting the right people, that can become very obsessionable. How to meet the right people, how to be in the right place, can become very obsessional. Going to the right place, type of transportation, type of house, everything can become obsessional. Your lifestyle, your lifestyle, how to work at it. I saw all this stuff and I said, wow, it is hard to get out of. Once you get caught up in the external world, it is tough, tough, tough to get out of it. Really tough. Brutally difficult, actually. It's extremely difficult to get out of all that stuff. I wanted to see what it's about and how difficult is it to get out of there. And what it's about is it's addictive, it's obsessional, and it's very tough to get out of any lifestyle you get into other than contemplation. Whatever it is, you will feel like entrapped by it, like it's a prison for you. And then you just try to do more of it. Instead of, I used to buy, go to thrift stores and buy, like 30 t-shirts in a day, that kind of thing. $1 a t-shirt, half price sometimes, 50 cents. All these really cool, t-shirts. I'd have 50 t-shirts. What do I do with those? And then I have to figure out, what do I wear today? How can I figure out exactly the right thing to wear today? What is the day all about? And he's trying to figure out how to wear the exact right thing for this exact moment. And you can't really figure it out. And you think somebody must know. Somebody somewhere must know, the right thing to wear. And of course, this obsession, this fashion obsession, is an extreme obsession in the world right now. And we are absolutely indoctrinating our children into this fashion obsession. It is incredible that it seems like children are just being turned into fashion plates. That is really terrible. My gosh, when I grew up it wasn't like that at all. All the clothes we had were hand-me-downs. They go, you know, the oldest, the next oldest. And we shopped secondhand. And wore, like, you know, I'd had one pair of pants. I'd wear them all year to school. One pair of jeans and a t-shirt and a pair of tennis shoes. That's it. I wore one pair of tennis shoes for, I think, almost 5 years. It was incredible. They were, what were they? I think they were Adidas. They were like the best shoes I ever had. They were incredible. And I wore them for years and years and years. That's all I wore. And I retired them finally and put them on the wall. And because that was my connection to this world, those shoes. That's all I ever wore. And same thing. The idea of putting on a fashion show at school was not even something I remotely ever even considered. Hated the very idea. I wore like a yellow t-shirt, a pair of blue jeans, and my sneakers, and that's it. But things have changed severely now. And the kids, the parents, I mean, my God, the just amount of clothes that are available to go shopping. And all the kids have to be accessorized in so many ways. And they're all have the latest cool trends, you know. It's gotten insane, totally insane. I went through a time of being extremely aware of fashion in every possible regard. Looking at that, because I realized it was going to be a overwhelming trend in the future, and how to get free of that ahead of time. You know, basically I did stuff that ahead of time, foreseeing what the future is going to be like, getting it out of the way before it becomes a world obsession, and then being free of it. So now I'm free of it. I can take it or leave it. I can still dress fashionably if I want to, but I don't really give it any thought anymore at all. I don't really shop anymore. Don't shop anymore at all. I don't have any money to shop, which helps a lot. So one of the benefits of not having money is you don't shop. So you can't feed obsessions so much. But anything other than, again, contemplation in seclusion almost, you the world gets a hold of you, sinks its fangs into you. I used to have hundreds of pairs of shoes. Hundreds. I got them used, again, like $2 or something. I had so many great shoes because people just, you know, trade them in. The fashions keep changing. And what is fashionable for 6 months is no longer fashionable, and people get rid of the shoes. I'd buy them. And so I had, you know, you wake up in the morning and you've just got like an unlimited array of shoes to choose from. Boots of all kinds, shoes of all kinds, sneakers, dress shoes, everything. Had really great stuff. If you live in a rich area where there's a thrift stores, the rich people turn in their clothes, you know, all their clothes constantly, and you can go buy a pair of like ballet shoes for like $5 or something, or Ferragamos, or all these, you know, super nice clothes, and you can get them, but they're out of style. They're out of style. So if you wear them, you're not going to really impress the fashionistas because they say, ah, that was last season. You know? And then you try to stay current by buying current season. The fact is, though, that only lasts for a short time, and then it's out of style. And if you get behind and you're out of style, then suddenly you're nowhere. You know, you are out. You're out of style. So the only people that can do that are very wealthy people. Very wealthy people. Or people who just spend all their money on that. My gosh, I have seen some people that are so fashionable, you could hardly believe it. You could hardly believe it. Maybe they're wearing $40,000 of clothes from top to bottom, you know, including like a $10,000 purse. And, you know, maybe the same $10,000 pair of boots, you know, and just, you know, incredible. And constantly changing and being in fashion like that. And we've gotten this worldwide obsession with fashion has been pushed upon us because it's supremely addictive. It turns us away from contemplation. That is what I experienced. I wanted to see what's the troubles? What are people facing in this world? and they're facing an onslaught. Why are there nobody with any vocations in the world now, right? In the developing countries, no vocations. In the poor countries, you know, they got a t-shirt, pair of shorts, and barefoot, or sandals, that's it. They see vocation as a way out of that. But here in the developed world, we are inundated with fashion and choices, inundated. And it is very tempting to remake yourself, do a, what do they call it, makeover. My gosh, you feel like, hey, I can make myself new, different, fresh. I have a fresh look every day. I had a fresh look every day. I could have literally thousands and thousands, almost infinite looks every day. If you combine all the pants, the shoes, the socks, the shirts of all types, the jackets, the hats. Oh my God, I had hundreds and hundreds of hats. Maybe 500, I don't know how many. All different kinds of hats, massive hat collection. So if you wanted to combine those, you literally have almost infinite variety. And so you feel like every day you can be a different person. You can be fresh and new and different, unique. Every day, it's an illusion. It's a delusion, because your belief system is the same. It doesn't change at all. You're only dealing with externals. You're dressing up a skeleton differently every day. It's still a skeleton. But it gives you this illusion that you are changing what you are every day, and you got the power of choice. It's a false power of choice. Again, you're only choosing among a constellation of effects. I could say, well, do I want Brooks Brothers? Do I want Ralph Lauren? You know, which line of Ralph Lauren do I want today? And do I want Burberry? Do I want on and on, Calvin Klein, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All this stuff, you know, shoes. Do I want the Nike, the Reeboks, the New Balance, the... on and on and on, the gels, just so many, many, many different brands. You know, what's the in brand, what's hot today, and just mix and match and come up and say, okay, here I am today. I'm look completely different than yesterday, or even different than this morning, or change. Sometimes I change three times a day, you know, and just different look, different look, different look, different look, and said, okay, how do I feel? I felt the same, really. Didn't touch what needs to be touched. There's no change, no change. And ties, oh my God, the number of ties I had was simply ridiculous. Hundreds and hundreds of ties. Sometimes you go into a thrift store and they'd have like bundles of ties, and someone would turn in their whole tie collection. It's very common, because you wear a tie for a couple times and that's it. You're not going to wear it again, usually. So you can buy 50 ties, you know, 50 ties for $50 or less. You do that enough times, you end up with 500 different ties. I had ties, and then I'd go to vintage stores and buy all this vintage clothing, shop for bargains, and I could dress in different styles. I could dress in the 60s, the 50s, go way back, even earlier than that, with all different accoutrements and hats, accessories, everything, or the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, whatever. Could shift time frames, so you get this feeling like somehow you're a time traveler. You have full choice of your experiencing. You don't. You still live right now, right here, no matter what kind of costume, what kind of masquerade you go through. Doesn't get you anywhere. Your belief system is still exactly the same. You're still in really the same situation as you've always been. And I had all sorts of costumes too. All sorts of costumes, my gosh. I could dress up in any way I wanted to. It's unbelievable. And I did. I wanted to see, what does this do? What does this costume do? What does that do? I just evaluated thousands and thousands and thousands of different looks. Sometimes I just spend, you know, all day just dressing up in different ways and then looking, say, what does this look like? What does this look like? What does that look like? How does that change anything? Nothing. Nothing, 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 nothing. Say, maybe a new hat, different hat. No. Change the tie. No. Change the shirt. No. Change the shoes. No. But change the cufflinks, you know. Change the watch. Change the accessories. Change this. Keep changing. Like a non-stop kaleidoscope. Constant changing. didn't do anything. So it's a waste of time, which is why in most ascetic, renunciate, monastic orders, vocational orders, is you have a simple dress and you wear the same thing all the time. It's the same. It's just very simple. Catholic school has a dress code, has uniforms. Basically, you wear these uniforms. That's the idea. There's no fashion show going on there. Everyone wears the same uniform. That's for a purpose. That's actually extremely helpful, believe it or not. But this world, the economics of this world, fashion is an integral part of everything that's going on this planet right now. Super important. And I did this incredible investigation into fashion for a long, long time. I studied it, I researched it, and because it's so vitally important right now, and I can tell you, it's all a waste of your time entirely. That's why you see the sages, they just have a shawl, you know. Kind of just a simple, simple dress. Always the same. No need to change anything, so to speak. They don't waste any time on that. When I was young, I hated to dress up in any way. Absolutely refused to do it. I said, give me my sneakers, a pair of shorts, and a t-shirt. That is all I want. And I'll wear that every single day without changing it at all. Didn't even worry about washing it. Forget it. That's all. Because it's a waste of time. I didn't want to waste my time. It is a waste of time. And yet, our entire model of developed civilization uses fashion constantly in advertising, in movies. Everything in movies, everything you see on television is integrally part and parcel of the fashion industry as well. Product placement. Everything you're seeing is by design. The clothes they're wearing. And they're showing you, look, you can be someone different than what you are by buying this stuff, by wearing this stuff. You can be different. Different pair of sunglasses. I had so many sunglasses too. Everything. Just put them over these glasses. Or take the glasses off and see how I look. And it doesn't do anything, but it gives the illusion that you're choosing, illusion of choice, that you're changing, you're making yourself a different person, you're doing a makeover, and all this stuff. We say, oh, I feel like I'm a different person because I've done this makeover. Yeah, you too can be a different person. So we see all these stars, these actors and actresses, these advertisements, these models, all this modeling, and they're all airbrushed, they're all digitally manipulated. They're all the images you're seeing, especially in the print and all of that, have been are artificial, are fake. The eye color, the lack of blemishes, and of course the models put on cake on makeup, so their flesh seems smooth and seamless and no blemishes, you know. Their hair, everything is fake. It's artificial. And we think, oh, if I just buy this product, I can get this freshness. No, I won't have any blemishes, you know. I'll feel like the model looks, you know, seems so free and happy and carefree and fresh and vital and young, and I'll be that way if I can get this product. It's really all a very, very vicious thing that's taking place in this world. False hope, distraction, the peddling of false hope gives an undercurrent of frustration which eventually boils over. And there's constant new looks coming in, never ending new looks. It's not like you reach a point and say, oh, this is the look, I've got it, I've nailed it. No. The whole industry runs on new looks, new looks, new looks, new seasons, new wardrobe, new decor, new styles and everything. Constantly new styles and never ending. I once did research into throughout history of women's hairstyles. You go back from the ancient times all the way up through these times, and you realize hairstyles have continuously changed, and it's never the same. It's unbelievable how many different hairstyles there have been. And then all the ornaments, the hats, everything, you know. It's incredible. You can't believe it. They don't think it's possible that there's always changing of clothes, of hairstyles, of how we look, how we accessorize. Everything is ceaselessly changing. There's never been a time when it hasn't. And the only ones that get it right are those who say, hey, wait a minute, let's just adopt a uniform here, and let's wear this uniform, and maybe you'll wear it for, you know, it'll be staying for 400 years or something. Keep it the same, very simple, very basic, and forget all about all of that, and spend your time researching into belief systems. When you do that, you find, you will find out that there is a way to free yourself from this rat race that we're in. And it's amazing how judgmental people are on your style, how you look, and all that. It's really a very something that we all kind of worry about. How do we look, you know? Sometimes there's back to nature styles in the 60s, hippie style. Oh my gosh, but hippie style was rigorous, you know. You had to be a really fashionable hippie. You really did. I mean, I couldn't cut the fashion. Then, I was just simply t-shirt and shorts and a pair of sneakers. That's all I cared about. And the hippies, they were the most fashionable. They were fashionistas, the hippies, I'll tell you that. Big time fashionistas. And later on, I'd go to vintage stores up in San Francisco, up in Haight-Ashbury, and get all these hippie clothes, and I, you know, was able to be a retro hippie as far as the style goes. You know, wow. All the embroidery, the flowers and embroidered stuff, and the leather stuff, the buckskin, and the fringes, and the tassels, and the vintage this and vintage that, and it was just an unbelievable fashion show, the hippies. You know, we were the squares, you know. I just had a t-shirt and shorts and a pair of sneakers in suburbia, and we were the squares. You know, the hippies were just exotic. You know, they had clothes from Marrakesh and from Madras, you know, and from Nepal, mixed in with some Italian designer stuff. And it was a potpourri of fashion. You know, they just were throwing all these thrift store fashions, just wild stuff, and constantly changing. It was an extreme fashion show. That's really where the fashion thing really took off in the mainstream, because before then, fashion was mainly for the upper classes, the wealthy people, the only ones that could afford it. You know, like the San Franciscans, the upper crust, the Nabobs of Nob Hill, go to, you know, I Magna and Saks Fifth Avenue and those kind of places. And they would constantly keep up with the seasons there, you know, and very strict about when you could wear white and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, they were very fashionable, very fashionable. And we're just hillbillies, you know, in the suburbs, just hillbillies, absolute hillbillies. Even now, when you're like, if you go up to a San Francisco Giants game, like on a Friday night, it's just really what it is, a fashion show, tell you the truth. Two kinds of fashion shows. It is the Giants gear, the merchandise. Everybody is absolutely decked out in every imaginable kind of fan gear. It's amazing. I feel like just taking photographs of it all, creating a slideshow, I could do that. It's mind-boggling. The money is kind of goes into those gearing up. But there's another type of fashion show too. There's that, and then there's all the, what do you call it? There's a name for it, French name. The young rich people of San Francisco, putting on their fashion show. Everybody's there to be seen, to see and be seen, and it's just all a fashion show. And the game, you know, you're hardly even aware there's a game taking place because everybody's just walking around the promenade. So many people, and they're on their, you know, their smartphones, taking pictures, tweeting, and they're wearing all this very fashionable. San Franciscans are so fashionable; they're so confident in themselves, fashionably, you know, as in projecting this kind of confidence, which is just superficial. You know, there's no substance to it at all, but it is, you know, they're in fashion, and everybody's showing each other who's in fashion. Who's a leader of the fashion? It's very intense. I don't even like going to games up there at all because you can't even focus on baseball. Nobody's really focused on baseball. Everybody is, you know, doing all their gadgets and going up to get their food and showing off how they look like and chatting and blah, 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 blah. And it's a huge scene. It is a huge scene. And baseball, you know, is there a game going on? Oh, what inning is it? What's the score? Oh, okay. And then back to the fashion thing. It's amazing. But it didn't used to be that way. Like a Candlestick Park, everybody's basically in their down parkas and freezing and paying attention to the baseball game. It's a very intense baseball atmosphere. But at AT&T Park in San Francisco, it's just this wild fashion show and status thing. Big time status thing there. Really. I mean, you got to bring your status. As a Giant fan, you better be geared up. If I just go there in normal clothes, I mean, who are you? I've followed the Giants baseball for 51 years religiously. I know, like, everything there is to know about it. I've listened to almost every game. But yet, you don't gear up. You're not in style. You don't have any status, et cetera, et cetera. Who are you? You're nobody. You're nobody. You're nobody. Where's your status? So the world is obsessed with status, with external status right now, really. And it's starting at such a young age in the fashion stuff. Oh, it's unbelievable. They copy these television and movie stars, want to look like them. It's unbelievable. I go up there, I see all these people, and they look like these movie stars, you know. They're trying to look like them, aping them, you know. How much time do they spend in contemplation? Probably none. Probably nothing. Probably nothing. And yet, you know, they're putting on the Ritz, status-wise. And I just shrug and say, well, you know, I've donated, you know, 100 times more clothes than you're probably ever going to have in your whole life. And it, to me, it's just like, okay, whatever. It's no big deal anymore. Who cares? It's not important. It's not important. It's fun, you know, but it's silly fun. But the problem is, silly fun turns into an obsession so easily in this world because there's a lot behind driving it. It's a distraction from contemplation, and that is profound. We don't realize in existence how addictive existence is. It's super easy to get addicted here. Super easy. Almost nobody escapes addictions here. No way. You can easily get caught up. Everybody gets caught up in something, you name it. Because existence is saying, don't examine your belief system, the belief systems. Don't look at it. Do anything other than that. Here, get into this. Get obsessed with that. Get obsessed with this. And if we don't get obsessed with it, existence is worrying, saying, uh-oh. They're not obsessed by it. Maybe they're going to look at the belief systems and realize the power of choice. So, existence wants us to be obsessed, wants us to be addicted, wants us to waste our time, wants to fritter away our lives in quest for status. My gosh, status is just such a heavy thing. It's everywhere. Is there ever anything even more heavy than the whole spiritual scene, the status there? Oh my gosh. Everybody desperately trying to pretend that they're not into status. And how to do that the right way, right? That becomes the status thing there. Okay, I gotta wear this, I better have this attitude, better do this and this and this, and that'll show that I'm not into status. Did I wear the wrong thing? I better, how do I wear this? I make it, you know, like I'm not really thinking about it, and I've got to make sure I'm dressed down right way, and oh my gosh, that becomes an obsession in itself, guaranteed. The hippies were obsessed with how they looked. You know, how do they look like they're not working for the man? How do they work, like, how they look, so they're part of the counterculture? You know, they don't dare not look that way. You know, it's all important. Gotta have their hair the right way. Oh my gosh, what a scene that became. You know, over in London, and on what, a high street, or what, a Broad Street or something, Piccadilly Circus, where all the shops were, all the hippies were out there, you know, desperately trying, searching for the right stuff. All the musicians too, everybody's part of the counterculture. They had to, you know, they were more obsessed with fitting in the status and the counterculture than the so-called squares and straights were fitting into the blah, you know, suburban culture. They're way more obsessed with it. And as such, you know, they didn't really spend much time in contemplation. It was all a game. It was a spiritual game. You know, I'm trekking. I'm on the hippie trail. You know, I'm going somewhere. I'm on the road to Marrakesh. I'm going to Pune. I'm going to Tiruvannamalai. I'm on my way to Goa. You know, I'm on transit. I've got my transit clothes. Okay, I've got this look. Oh, now I've got this look. You know, and they bring back their treasures, and then they make their hippie pad. You know, with their rugs and their draperies and all the brocade and then the embroidered stuff and the right linens from India and the right necklaces, right? Gotta have the right beads from India and the right prayer beads, the right incense, the right music. On and on and on and on and on. And I'm just trying to say, guys, come on, let's get into some real talk and consideration of the truth. And they say, who are you? You know, you're not part of us. And I say, what can I do to be part of you? And they say, well, you know, you don't fit in quite right. So then you start accessorizing, start trying to find, you know, what's the right look? And then again, get pulled into it. And you find out that's all that's really going on. What's really going on? Never get to the contemplation. Never get to it. Same with the music scene. You never get to the contemplation. There's no scene where you ever get to it. There's no scene that you get to what you need to get to. So finally, I just, you know, I'm just going to sit in a cave and get to it. Forget it. Forget about all these scenes. But the problem is then you drop out, really drop out, and then you feel like you don't fit in anywhere, and that becomes a problem in itself too. Very difficult here. It's not easy. You have to, no matter what you do, it's not easy. I heard Richard Bach had an airplane accident. Hope he's feeling better. He was a counterculture icon when I grew up. Jonathan Livingston Seagull, and he wrote all these books about freedom and self, finding the self, and that eventually morphed into soulmates. He was like the original soulmate daddy, and eventually he got divorced, which blew everybody's minds, you know, because they thought that you got to find your soulmate. Everybody's looking for their soulmate, and they say, you know, one upsmanship there is, well, you know, who has the best soulmate? Who's found their true soulmate? You know, is this their true? Everyone's saying, well, is this my true soulmate, or do I just think it's my true soulmate? It became an obsession, soulmate obsession. It's still going on in some places. And one-upsmanship everywhere. Everyone is trying to convince others that they've got it, or they're on the right track, when in fact nobody doing all that stuff is on the right track. They're not. The people on the right track, you'd never even see them, because they're probably somewhere in their room just contemplating. You know, they're just little church mouses. You don't even recognize them. I was invisible. Nobody, I was not on anyone's radar screen at all. And after I went through enough contemplation and got enough momentum going, then I started evaluating the whole world in various ways to see, you know, what is causing the problem in the world. How bad is it going to be? How can I make sure I don't get caught up in the future and just kind of clearing it all out, clearing the future out? So at this point here, I'm able to do what I'm doing. If I hadn't have cleared all this stuff out, I wouldn't be able to do this. I would be caught up in some scene with the rest of the world. The rest of the world is caught up in some scene. Politics is a big scene, you know. I've never done the politics thing, really. Never done that. That's a huge scene. Certain people are really into that. Non-stop. It's now non-stop. There is no off-season in politics. That's a great way to be distracted. A great way to avoid contemplation. See, a lot of ways, you know. Oh my gosh, there's a lot of ways. And the world is really, you see these kids these days, these young kids, oh boy, so into fashion, status, going to the right schools, the right places is all so important, it's super important. How to, you know, fit in some scene, some gain status. And of course the fight for jobs now is so intense that it's getting just more and more and more and more intense now in the world. Is people are desperate to look the part, get the right connections, be part of the right scene, fit in so that they can get a high-paying career and job. You know, it's becoming more and more difficult. That the competition is ferocious. Ferocious. You have these helicopter parents that are with their children constantly now. Because they want them to succeed in the world, as it were, and they know that the competition's ferocious. I for some reason, stuff happens to me that is helpful, just by just sitting there. I just went to get an oil change, and there's some guy, a college guy who used to work, went back to college, and he was explaining to me the pressure he's under, and how intense it is. And he says there's zero tolerance for missing any part of your schedule. You have to stay on schedule. If you don't, he said there's 100 people who will take your place. The competition is so fierce. And he said he had to just chug energy drinks and constantly just to stay up with the pace. He said, there's no other way. I can't sleep. I got to just work. It's so intense. He says, if I don't keep up, if I miss a supervisor appointment with my supervisor, all this kind of stuff, he says, I'm out. I'm out of this program because there's 100 people petitioning to take my place, you know, and then they just say, no, if you can't keep up, you're out. It's brutal, utterly brutal what's going on, the competition now. Because again, the job market is contracting so severely in the world that, you know, it's survival, it's desperation time. These people are willing to chug energy drinks nonstop just to, you know, get the grade, make the grade, graduate, and get some job. And how much time do you think he spends times contemplating? How about 0 seconds? Maybe that little talk he had with me is maybe the only time he's had in a long time to just talk with somebody with no pressure. You know, I was just listening. You know, I just relaxed. I'm under no pressure, so to speak. And maybe that helped. I don't know. Talk with people. They explain the world, what they're going through right now. Wow. It's just as horrible as I thought it was. It really is. The pressure on people is ungodly right now. Who can spend their time contemplating it? Basically, it's like committing suicide. Because, you know, you'll completely fall behind, drop out, no job, you know, nothing. I mean, and if you have bourgeois middle class sensibilities, basically where it is taboo to depend on the government for anything, you have to make your own way. You're self-reliant. You cannot count on simply sponging off the government. No way. You don't have those skills. They're not part of your conscience won't even allow you. The idea of getting some kind of benefits from the government is just like complete anathema. You just don't do that. That is like dishonorable, completely dishonorable. And so, you know, the competition is just completely vicious and horrible. And if you drop out and just spend your time contemplating on your own, you know, you'll fall down to the bottom rung of the food chain, of the work chain, really severely. You may end up with no retirement. You may end up in my situation, which from a financial standpoint is a complete disaster. Terrible. But the ace in the hole is that I could choose unconditional love. I can make that choice. I'm aware enough to make that choice, which would change everything. Change everything. Because then the world will be the path to your door, at least those who are aware of the opportunity. And the pressure is so bad that some people start teaching before they've chosen unconditional love just because they need an income, you know? I'm not getting any income out of this at all. It's all public domain, Creative Commons public domain. I'm not going to make a cent off of it. But and I don't deserve to because it's not the full. I haven't chosen unconditional love yet, so it's not the full teaching. When you do choose unconditional love, then whatever comes your way is justified entirely. If the entire wealth of the planet were poured into your coffers, if you've chosen unconditional love, it's totally justified, totally justified. So whatever happens then, you know, it's justified as far as whatever good fortune occurs is totally justified. It's not a worry. But the pressure that people are under now drives them into teaching, prematurely. And that's where you get, you know, so many, many, many teachers and advisors, etc. in the world. They don't have it. They don't have it. And yet, you know, how can you not feel for them? Because they're just trying to make a living, you know? They're just trying to survive. So I don't judge them that way at all. No, I understand. Just, you know, they're trying to sell a book. Trying to pay their mortgage. Trying to give the best advice they're capable of, which they do. It's not the right advice in most cases. But, you know, they gotta eat. They have to eat. And, you know, if they're into that whole thing, there's not a whole lot of opportunity, economic opportunity at all, spiritually. Remember, it used to be vocations in religions, and that was all taken care of. You didn't have to worry about money at all once you entered a vocation. That was all done by tithing through the parishioners of the churches, being shared and spread out all throughout the entire structure of a religion. So if you'd had a vocation, that you'd have room, board, and clothing, and medical care for life, and never have to worry about any of that. So it's a vastly preferable system than what we have now, where you, if you're on your own, like in my case, just entirely on my own as far as contemplation and getting this done, I don't have any programs, I don't have any assistance from a religious organization, from the government, anything like that, no. The only assistance I've gotten is from my family. That's it. And, you know, if you don't have a family, you know, what do you do then? You need assistance from friends. And so it's brutal. It's really brutal. And the problem with the vocations is that it's kind of watered down, really. It's always been watered down. And for me, I thought, you know, way too slow. I have to succeed this life. That's it. and these vocations, you know, it just seemed like it was too institutionalized and too slow, and like, yeah, this is not going to get the job done. No way. No, and basically, the religions are based on the beliefs that are not true. Okay. A mistaken belief system is based on that. Most of them are very much based on that. So, you know, you'd have to disagree with the fundamental premises, and that wouldn't get you anywhere. You know, you might, you know, I don't know what they do, what you have a vocation, but I don't know what happened. Wouldn't work out very well. So, I mean, I'm looking at the world and saying, how can the world be helped? Oh, boy. It's really something right now. I'm telling you. I'd like to have an answer. But it is... it's really individualistic. It's really... You have to somehow bootstrap yourself. You have to be very innovative, very adaptive, and being a genius and using expedience. You really have to be a genius to succeed. And the good news is you are a genius. That is, everyone here is a genius. Everyone, without exception. And it's just how we use our genius is the question. You know, Muji talks about, you know, how he got by, you know, and it's like amazing, you know, how could anyone do that? Didn't have any money. You know, and it's just like, he just wandered around and people took care of him and stuff. He had a genius to do it. He had a genius to do it, no question about it. And yet we all have a genius to somehow do it in different ways. It's different for everybody. You know, most of us couldn't do it the way Muji did at all. No way. He had almost off the charts personal charisma, off the charts. I've never seen anything like it, really. And, you know, this is someone who could make a bucket full of friends in an afternoon, and they'd all invite him over to their place, you know, say, stay with me, stay, why don't you stay with me? Just like that, you know. The rest of us, there's not the slightest chance that anything like that could ever happen. It's out of the question, you know. I couldn't make a friend if my life depended on it, really. So, totally different thing. Totally different situation. Everybody has a unique way. I just simply have made the best of my situation, whatever it, you know, what it is. Just make the best of it. You have to make the best of your situation, whatever it is. Don't think it has to be like someone else's situation. You don't have to be like Muji, you know, in London. You don't have to be that way. You don't have to be like me, holed up in a cave in the suburbs, you know. Don't have to be like that, you know, bored out of your mind, trying to find a way to just make a way, you know, with your time and your years and your life, seemingly doing nothing as far as success goes, but actually taking the path to ultimate success, the only success that is actually success. Everything else is hypothetical, plausible success. The world runs on plausible success, which is really no success at all. It's always projected into the future. So you're just chasing your tail, really. I mean, you just continue, chasing after that, you know, end of the rainbow, thinking that you're almost there. You're almost there. You must be, you're closer now than you used to be. You must be, because you put the time in. You said, well, I've lived to be 80 years, and so I must have had 80 years of progress. Plausible, but not true. 80 years of wasting time is what it really boils down to. So we're just having this chat. This is just a life chat here, you know. Just sharing what I've gone through. Very intense life of tremendous inquiry. Super focused inquiry into this world. What's really going on here? What can we expect in the future? How can we prepare for that? How can we get ready for it? How can we sidestep it? How can we have already worked it out, so we're just, you know, say forget it? don't need to get caught up into all these obsessions and addictions. I can tell you, people don't learn. People don't learn. Generation after generation just repeats the same mistakes over and over and over again. It's unbelievable. You'd think that people would have learned from the hippie generation that drugs are bad. No, they did not. That's something I cannot believe. Now they're showing that teens that use marijuana consistently, their IQ drops as they age more than the norm. Definitely does. Duh, you know. As if, do we really need a study to know that? Anyone from my generation should have know that easily. Are you kidding? It's amazing that there's no transference of wisdom from one generation to the next anymore. We weren't able to transfer our wisdom forward. That's one of the great regrets I have, you know, of my life. Couldn't transfer it forward. Because each generation now feels so separate from the preceding one. It's like the ability to feel separated is getting stronger and stronger. Each generation thinks that they know way more than the preceding generation, and they don't have to listen to anything because they're so intrinsically smarter that they can whatever they figure out is bound to be better than anything we could figure out, you know, which is ludicrous. We were geniuses too in our time. We would just have a different emphasis, you know, but still, same genius is there. All generations are geniuses. Everyone here is a genius. And we found out all about a lot of stuff in that era. The 60s, the hippie generation, flower children, all of this stuff. We found out so much. But nobody listened to what we learned, really. And you know, some of them just passed on. Yeah, it's all groovy. It's great. No, it's not great. It's terrible. What a waste of time. You know, don't repeat our wastage of time. Don't do that. And each generation just does the same stupid things, wasting time. It's amazing. It's good to listen to older people. Super smart to do that. Real geniuses do that. You know, using your genius the right way. You listen to the older people because not because they're more genius than you are, but because they've already spent a lot of time doing stuff that doesn't work, and then they can tell you, hey, this doesn't work. Don't repeat. Don't waste your time on this. And then you can begin to get a sense of, wait a minute, maybe all of this is a waste of time. Because I went back through history and so many different things I pursued from now, present time, all the way back to the very beginnings of civilizations. Many different tangents pursued all the way back. And then I could see the whole thing and say, wait a minute, none of this worked ever. And so it probably will never work. All of it was a waste of time. And then you start thinking, wait a minute, maybe all of existence is a waste of time. I don't see anything that isn't. I haven't found anything that isn't a waste of time. All of the trends throughout history, gone with the wind, all of the folly, all of that. And you just say, wait a minute. Even though we're doing a new trend now, a new fad, is it really going to be different than the previous fads? Because I've already studied thousands of fads throughout history. I've seen all of these fads. And so why do we think this fad is somehow going to be, you know, give us a the result we really want when none of these fads have ever done that? It's kind of crazy to expect a different result from, do the same thing expecting a different result than you've ever gotten. So I said, well, maybe none of this is going to work. Maybe it's, you know, it's a waste of time, all this stuff. You know, so maybe better not waste your time with any of that stuff. Let's inquire into existence itself, the root of it. Why is it the way it is? Instead of pursuing some trend, why not just say, wait a minute, hold on, put the brakes on. Let me ask some deeper questions than that. You know, what's this all about? What's this all about? And music doesn't work. I mean, during the, when I grew up, I mean, the music was unbelievable. It was the best musical era ever. I believe that because it was a combination of the super sophistication of the classical and the orchestral disciplines melded with pop, okay, and blended in with the new age, avant-garde, experimental stuff that was coming in, and the electronics, and everything was blended together, and you still had all these session musicians that were incredibly talented playing on all these songs, and the strings were there, the orchestra was there, the everything, the songwriters, you know, it was just done superbly tailored, and the artistry was just incredibly tasteful. And then you had the innovation combined with that. The musicians were very talented, and you had tremendous creativity. And then you had the whole drug scene where the musicians were just doing all sorts of weird stuff. But the quality of musicianship and production was, they used a vacuum tube, everything, which gave a richer feel to it all. You know, digital is very flat in many ways, and so you had this pinnacle of music. It was so incredible. We really thought that music was going to save the world, that we were going to produce music that would make everybody happy. We really believed it. Really, that was what people believed at that time, because the music was incredible. I mean, the Beatles, you know, I give them a lot of criticism for a lot of reasons, but musically, they're very talented. Very innovative. And so you combine it with Abbey Road Studio, which was for classical music. And the engineers and producers and everything there were so professional and experienced. And they had access to all these session players and orchestral instrumentalists and arrangers, composers, arrangers. Everything was there, and they could make stuff, you know, just incredibly, you know, synthesis of all these different styles, and it was amazing, and everything was just taking off in all the different directions, but still very well done. And it was a high point in musical history, and being that I, my history is musician and music, you know, I felt like riding this wave that somehow we were going to enlighten the world, you know, elevate the world through music is what we were trying to do. And boy, did we fail at that big time. A colossal depression hit me, because when the music started dying, when the heavy stuff started coming in, and the whole thing turned in such a bad direction, where the drugs got heavy, people got really weird, they got nasty and vicious, and things just completely deteriorated, and continued on. I don't even listen to music anymore. I mean, there's still a lot of innovation, but the feeling is it's just not there, you know. We had very, very tasteful, soulful, beautifully tailored music in every way. You know, it's like you couldn't hardly imagine doing it any better than it was done. Yeah, like the Beach Boys, you know, at Capitol Records, on the simplest of recording situations, about a couple tracks, I don't know if they have 3-4 tracks, the most, being extremely ingenious in composing these unbelievably sophisticated, beautiful songs that just, like, you never heard anything like it. So this is unbelievable. Like some from some other dimension or something, how they could accomplish that. And then that, you know, gradually fell apart, and then decay entered into the whole music scene so badly, where the motive was different, the agenda was to tear down. Let's tear it down, let's be angry and tear everything down. Whereas what we were trying to do is let us access subtler energy, subtler feelings. That's the purpose of it. Let us open the door to other realms of greater beauty, greater light, greater subtlety. That's the whole purpose. That, from a musical standpoint, that's why I came into the world. It is from a personality, musical standpoint, because I had the capability of doing that. And it was an ideal time for it, but things turned so quickly. Wow. Could not do it. didn't have the time to do it. You had to seize the moment very quickly. I wasn't quite old enough to move in that direction properly, and it still didn't work. It didn't work at all because, again, subtle realms of energy are not the answer. And you had world music was starting then. Sitars were being put into stuff. All different instrumentation around the world was being used, but tastefully, with highest standards, you know. And you just like, oh gosh, this is unbelievable, this music. It's world music. The whole world is going to, you know, I want to compose, you know, infinite number of songs and operas and compositions and have the whole world singing and elevating, you know, and I want everyone to relate musically. When in the 60s, you know, we related musically. I did. I knew every song there was. We'd talk to people. You'd say, what do you think about this song and how they did this? And maybe, have you heard this group and that song and the way, you know, and okay, the instruments they use, who was playing them, and do you think they could have done it this way? Everything revolved around music and how can we make it better? How can we elevate our fellow beings here on this planet, you know, to higher natural high through music? And we were very judgmental about what is good and good music and what is not, you know, what is tearing down, what is depressing us and what is elevating us. And it was a very serious thing. What bands have you seen? What albums do you have? What are you listening to now? How, you know, is that the right stuff to listen to? You know, folk music was very big because folk music was supposed to, it was a movement to elevate the workers of the world and to improve the lot of the working class. And it was very, very important. Like Bob Dylan was like a, you know, a god to those people. And then he went electric with the band. He did a recording session there in upstate New York, and he came out, I think, one of these jazz festivals and started playing electric guitar. He went over to England, actually, and played in a festival there. And he got crucified because he was going electric. See, he changed. The people wanted this folk music to elevate the sensibilities of the working class. So music was a very serious thing. It was the cornerstone of movements. People rallied around music, very much so. And that was my purpose, wanting to rally people around music. Failed at that purpose entirely, and drastic failure. Because the way the music changed, and it's just like, oh my gosh, you know, unbelievable what's happened. I got super, super depressed over that. It was devastation. And never will I place my faith in music again. No way. I don't even listen to music anymore. You talk about being disappointed. I mean, you know, we hit the high point in the 60s. Have we ever heard a group like the Beach Boys, some of their songs, have we ever heard anything any better than that? No. No. No way. Some of that, a lot of their songs that are not popular are even better than the ones that are popular. I used to know every single song they ever made, and some are just, you can hardly believe how beautiful it is. And yet, you know, that fell apart, too many drugs, everything, arguments, legal things, et cetera, et cetera. And has there ever been something, you know, better? No, things change, tastes change. And along comes all this different kind of music, you know. And then that changes too. And now, you know, I look for music and it's like, what? It's all this electronic, you know, ambient stuff. You know, it's like, okay, you know, there's some really cool stuff there too. But it doesn't seem to have the same resonance of gripping the entire energy structure and elevating it. You know, it's kind of just sort of introducing some kind of dimension, energy dimension, but it doesn't seem to grip the entire energy structure. But of course, gripping the energy structure isn't the answer. Music is not the answer. I can tell you that for sure. I can probably tell you that better than anybody on this planet, that music isn't the answer. I have such an intense experience and involvement with that. Music is not the answer. Forget it. You can listen to it or not listen to it, doesn't matter. But it's never going to be the answer. Never. It's got nothing to do with the answer. The answer is you choosing a new idea. That is the answer. What does music have to do with that? Nothing. Nothing. I used to practice 10 hours a day or more because I wanted to be so good. I wanted to give music that elevated the world. I wanted to be able to produce that music instrumentally and then later vocally, and whatever I could do to try and help the musical scene elevate it, I would spend all my time at that just intense effort, and it all came up to nothing, absolute nothing, completely useless. And yet so many are still, you know, counting on musicians to save them. Musicians don't save anybody. They never have. There's never been a musician save anybody. It's not the road to salvation at all. It's a great distraction. It's a great distraction. Because you think, you know, you're feeling subtler stuff in the music, right? You tune into music and you're aware of subtler stuff. Subtler beauty, right? And you think, oh, okay, there's something better, I can make progress. You don't realize that's just in other energy patterns. And you don't see the context of these energy patterns, that they're a hypothetical situation, and the hypothetical has a purpose to it, which is to make destruction real. And so you're going to be caught up in trauma and continuous change. You know, there's nothing worse than a great musician who has a style and they're very successful and everyone loves them, and then the trends change and they become totally out of style, passé. Nobody goes to their concerts, nobody cares anymore. What can you do? You know, you have your style and you were great at it and nobody is interested in that style anymore. What do you do? It's horrible. Absolutely horrible. I'm looking at the video now and I kind of look like George Jones. I really do. The Possum. Great singer. One of the all-time greatest singers ever been on this planet. And, he did country music. And then styles changed, you know. And, you know, he stuck to his guns and kept doing it. He tried to do some other stuff, but it just didn't sound right at all. And he was so good that he still has a lot of people listening to him. But for most people, you know, the musicians, they're out of style. They're forget it. They're gone. Unless they have a very loyal following, they get people really obsessed with them and stick with them their whole lives, which happens to some of the top stars. They, no matter what they do. But for most musicians, you know, they're, you know, like if you're a big band musician, big band went out of style, you're gone, you know, forget it for a long, long time. Eventually it came back a little bit, but brutal. Trends change in this world. Trends always change. Always. And so if you're basing your foundation on a trend, you're asking for trouble. But truth is not a trend. Satsang is not a trend. Something you can do every day of your life is inquiry. Inquire into the world. The world's right here. It's not going anywhere. Not yet. So you can inquire into it. Say, you know, what's really going on here? I see all this stuff. Wait a minute. Wait just a minute. You know, what is it we're dealing with here anyway? Inquiry. You can do inquiry. You can do it your whole life. It's even better than golf. They say you can play golf your whole life. You can also inquiry your whole life. Take it with you. You don't even need golf clubs for that. You just need attentiveness and willingness Do it. Just do it. Just do it. Just do inquiry. Nobody can stop you from it. Nobody can stop you. Wherever you are, you can just observe. Just observe like you're nothing. You're nobody from nowhere. And nobody's interested in you. And you're just a fly on the wall. And you're just observe. Just be observant. Quiet. Don't try to seize upon a conclusion. Rather, just notice, and see. What do you see? What is going on? Can I see a bigger picture? Expand, generalize. See if you can make connections, connect the dots. Keep working like that. Wherever you are, waiting for a dentist, you know. I mean, wherever you are, driving, no matter what you're doing, let yourself have the opportunity. Some things, like watching television, I found it impossible to do inquiry. Very difficult, really. Movies, same thing. Incredibly difficult. Manual work, also incredibly difficult. Doing manual labor, very difficult to do inquiry. Active, real active stuff, very difficult. It's better to be in a passive situation, but not watching, trying to follow a plot line and all the stuff like in movies and television, all this stuff. What I do is I just sit in a chair and there'd be a blank wall there, you know, nothing there. No pictures, nothing, just blank wall, and just kind of let your eyesight just kind of diffuse, not really looking at anything, and the world drops away. You're not even thinking about the world. You've gone in deeper, greater depth. You're doing inquire into this world, and you can do it anytime, any, you know, wherever you are, throughout your entire life. You can do that. Now, reading books, unless they're very much attuned to inquiry, that also is a problem. So it's kind of difficult just to sit, you know, sit and do nothing. But wise people do that. I mean, they'll sit on their porch, you know, in the evening, and just listen to the crickets, and they're just kind of relaxed, you know. And what are they doing? They're probably contemplating. You see, the world, a slower pace of a world is super important. Super important. The pace of life. Now, it mitigates against contemplation. Especially like in the Silicon Valley here, Bay Area. My gosh, it's one of the most pressure cooker paces of life on the planet. And you can tell there's not a lot of contemplation taking place here. That is for sure. There's a lot of innovation. No contemplation. Innovation is a booby prize. It's the fake success. Pace of life, super important. That it's slow pace of life. Take those walks. You know, you can contemplate while you're taking a walk. I didn't find that helpful. I found it actually much more helpful to just sit in a chair, or like sitting on a bench like this. Just sit on a bench or a chair. Don't move your body hardly at all. Just be still, be quiet. And if you're walking along, it's possible to do it that way. Some people maybe can. If you really, you can get into it. I was able to do. I tried that out and I was able to do it. But sitting is probably the easiest way, the best way. But where can we just simply sit on a bench? I mean, it used to be that people, you know, would just sit on benches, like I would just sit on a bench in a park somewhere. Sit there for the day. Just sit there for the day, just looking out over the park, and the people playing and moving around. Just sit there, and just take the whole thing in panoramically, without trying to follow any plot or storyline. But just saying, wait a minute, let me disengage myself from all this day-to-day dramas, and let me just see if I can see the bigger drama. What is this all about, really? And you can do that. That can be done. imagine John Lennon sang the song Imagine, but I would change those words, most definitely. Imagine, you know, that there's a world where we can all just sit quietly without anyone interrogating us. What are you doing sitting there doing nothing? Because actually, you do the most by sitting there quietly, not seeming to do anything. You can actually do the most work that way. By far and away, nothing's even close. When you want to be a true workaholic, just sit quietly and do nothing. And observe everything that arises as you're just sitting there doing nothing. Observe the obsessions, observe the pressures, observe all the dynamics that are, you know, that surface and say, hey, you got to do something, and all this stuff. Observe everything, and you'll do unbelievable amount of work that way. So it's not lazy at all. It's intense. Nothing more intense than just sitting still very quietly. Nothing more intense than that. It's more intense than jumping off a bridge or jumping out of an airplane, really. Because you're jumping into the depths of belief, the depths of existence. You're jumping into all of that, and you're seeing it as it is. It's more intense than jumping out of an airplane. By far and away, it is. Nothing comes close. The intensity that I went through, nothing. You want intensity, that's where it's at. And again, don't take drugs, because that lessens the intensity. People think it increases the intensity, it lessens the intensity. It throws everything out of whack. You don't get the depth. You really don't get into the true intensity of it at all. It gives a fake intensity. That's the thing about drugs. They're so bad, they give you fake intensity. It's not the real intensity at all. No, not even close. No way, no how. People think that they're tripping. Oh, that was really intense, man. No, it's not. If you do inquire by just sitting still, sober as can be, clear as can be, quiet as can be, still as can be, with no agenda to do anything except other than to observe very carefully and consider and contemplate, that will get you into real intensity. Yeah, and the whole drug scene is just they're just role playing, you know. It's just a game. There's no real intensity there. And again, the same thing with any stimulants too. Stimulate, same thing. It's not. It feels intense, but it's not real intensity. It's not real intensity. Again, the complete sobriety, sitting still, not trying to do anything or go anywhere, get any answer, so just contemplate. Look at the picture. Look at the picture. That is the highest intensity you're going to get. You're going to be like, oh my gosh. You're going to be in shock. It's so intense. But it's great. You're already still, so nobody knows you're in shock. You just sit there. Nothing changes. You're just sitting there very quietly. Okay. Like this. Just sit there like this. And you don't want to be obvious. You can, you know, you can just move a little bit and like you're looking at stuff. But that's just like, kind of like, just so you don't feel like you're a statue. You know, you don't want to stand out like I'm a statue. But when you just being still and observing and looking at the picture, you start seeing stuff you never saw before and never thought you'd ever see. And you realize that the only way you're ever going to see this is by what you're doing right now. And that just blows your mind. You just say, holy cow, this is intense. Wow. And yet you're just sitting there and you just keep sitting there. You don't do anything. You don't jump up and do a dance. You know, you might feel like it, but no, you just keep sitting. Like nothing happened. End of the day, you leave the bench, you go home or whatever. And like nothing ever happened. But a ton of stuff happened. You saw more clearly than you ever have seen before. And every day you can do that. You can see more clearly than you ever did before. That's usually my experience. Each day, the clarity is greater than it ever had before. And that's very intense. where with like people with drugs, they need more and more and more and more and more to try to get that high again and again. And gradually it all becomes boring and dull. And, you know, I mean, if you went through the whole drug culture in the 60s, you saw what happened. You saw what happened. All these people that they thought were so trippy and high and intense and profound, etc., they got it all on drugs. And then later you look at them, you know, they're like, they're a shell. They're nothing. They just, you know, it all ended. They all crashed and burned. A lot of them didn't last. You burn out, severe burnout. It doesn't happen in satsang. You don't get burnout. You get nervous and fearful because you're looking at stuff that's all these taboos that says I'm not supposed to look, but you don't get burned out at all. You know, you get better and better and better and better and better at it. More and more clear, more and more courageous, more and more capable. You go further and further and further. You don't burn out. You become ennobled. You become very clear and wise and focused and able to look even deeper, you know, into the depths that, you know, previously you thought you never could reach at those depths. Now you can even reach those depths, and you get better and better and better at it. It's the ultimate path. In a previous life, I was a virtuoso and on the piano, and super hard to keep up the virtuosity. Intense practice, intense, and it always is slipping away, slipping away, slipping away, slipping away. And it's a nightmare, you know, trying to be a virtuoso. You can't keep it up. And you get old, you age. You get worse and worse and worse and worse, and it slips, and you try to hide it, etc., etc., etc. Whereas in contemplation, satsang, clarification, contemplation, you get better and better and better and better and better. So it's not like you're a musician or some skill where the skills erode over time and you get worse and worse and worse at it. In contemplation, you get better and better and better. I'm better now than I've ever been. I may not do it with the same amount of time, but the depth is greater and greater and greater. It's like, let's say there's a virtuoso who, you know, just plays fabulously, and when they're 50, 56, they're like way, way, way better than they were when they were 40. You know, 10 times better. You don't see that. You don't see that. And you know the virtuosos in various things and in various instruments, you know, the cello, the violin, the piano, the horns, or whatever. Stuff that, you know, it's intense, it's very difficult. They dedicate their lives entirely to maintaining this virtuosity. And it's an obsession, really. And it's a waste of time, really. But actually, I parlayed that into being able to focus on contemplation in this life. The ability to be intensely dedicated to something over a whole lifetime. A virtuoso has to be dedicated their whole life to the instrument that they're playing, and to a large extent. I was not my livelihood did not depend on my virtuosity, so I actually did other things. So I wasn't like the top flight virtuosos who literally their whole life depended on their virtuosity. Thank God for that. So at least I had some perspective, some additional perspective. Like then I was able to translate into a life of contemplation, which is vastly superior to any life of virtuosity. Vastly superior. I can tell you from my own experience, looking at past lives, I'm able to see what is better. What's the best life? The best life is a life of contemplation. Nothing can touch it. Nothing else. It's the best life possible in existence. You live that life because you get better and better and better and better and better. And you get closer and closer and closer and closer and closer to choosing a new idea. And you get more and more and more hope. And you're able to shed more and more and more of the existence. And it's everything. It's a positive spiral that you realize you're going to succeed completely. So how can you beat that? You can't beat it. Because no other path gives that feeling. of true hope and true success. No other path brings you to what you really want. No other path does. No other lifestyle does. No way. You can be an Epicurean, you know. You can be a bon vivant. You can be, you know, a trendsetter. You can be a social leader. You can be a politician. You can be all these things, a titan of industry, an innovator. You name it. You can be it. A healer. You can, your whole life can be dedicated to it. But it's like nothing compared to dedicating your life to contemplation, because all those other things, they don't give you what you really want. They don't give you even a clue how to get what you really want. They don't even give you a clue about it. Whereas contemplation, you find out how to get what you really want, which is to choose a new idea, a new positive agent. That's the only way. And the only way you're going to find that out is through contemplation. A life of inquiry is the only way you're going to discover that. And you can hear somebody say it, but it's not a discovery for you. You have to see it. You have to work out, iron out the resistance to it in your own life. Whatever forms of resistance are, and resistance can come up in infinite forms, you have to iron that out. So it's no longer a problem for you. Like a virtuoso might play the song, you know, 10,000 times, and in the 10,000th time, they're still ironing stuff out to make it even better, you know, like that. So you can translate that kind of discipline into a life of contemplation, where I'm contemplating for the umpteenth day, you know, still trying to iron out resistance, still trying to make, you know, iron it out. It's in my makeup to do that. Totally in my makeup to do that. And just stick with it. Say, ah, the composition, I was a composer too. Composition is not perfect yet. So I have to, you know, look at the structure, change some notes, and try to make it a little better. Well, that gets translated into contemplation. So I have to go a little deeper, a little deeper. Contemplation is about depth, 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 depth. Get to the root of the situation. Get to the root of the resistance. And see it all as one, you know, packaged thing. Generalize it all. It just takes discipline, discipline, discipline to, you know, discipline life. Keep doing it, keep doing it. A disciplined life within a context of kind of non-discipline is tough, because situations are fluid in the world. Everything's always changing, you know, you're not have a vocation when you're in a nunnery or a monastery. You know, you're trying to adapt and get along with life. At the same time, you have to contemplate all the time and keep up the contemplation. It's like being a musician, where you keep going to different cities and you're performing in different cities, constantly traveling, and yet everywhere you go, you still have to pull off a great performance. You know, you have to give people their money's worth. It's like that. I mean, you still have your life. And yet, within that life, you still have to pull off the contemplation whenever you can do it. Maybe you'll go to bed and spend 3 hours before you go to sleep contemplating. Or maybe you'll wake up at 4 a.m. and you can't get back to sleep, and you'll spend 5 hours in the morning contemplating. That's what I did a lot. I couldn't sleep. I'd wake up at 2 a.m, couldn't get back to sleep, and then I'd spend, you know, I contemplate till 8, 10 a.m. or noon, you know, 8 hours sometimes straight. 10 hours, contemplate, you know, all the time like that. So whatever situation you're in, instead of just saying, distracting yourself with some stupid video game or, you know, whatever, contemplate. Use the time to contemplate. You'll never regret it. Whatever time you spend in contemplation, you won't regret that time spent that way. Because it will move you towards real hope and actually choosing a new idea and freeing yourself from this massacre and experiencing, instead of that, unconditional love and true safety. You're actually moving yourself towards that. Every minute you spend in contemplation moves you forward, moves you down the tracks towards that. And so you have to take it seriously, so seriously that you don't even bother talking about it. It is your life. It is your lifestyle. Everything else is secondary. And yet you still have to live your life, too. You still have to live your life, but you have to make time for contemplation, which is what I did. I just turned down everything else, you know, whatever offers, do here, go here, do this, that. No, forget it. You know, go out to lunch, go out to dinner, forget it. No, I cannot do it. Just turn it down, turn everything down. There's a game on, there's a show on, forget it. Want to see a movie? No. You know, no. And of course, you don't really have a social life if you do that constantly, which is fine because there's less, more time for contemplation. But you can even work in, you know, a little bit of social life too. It's possible. Everyone's different. But you still have to give yourself the opportunity. Opportunity, opportunity. Wherever you are, find a way to dig deeper. Not some cheap philosophical theory. Okay? No, the real stuff. Really looking directly at existence. Look at it. See what's really there. It's, nobody does that. They just take hearsay on everything. Everything's secondhand here. Everybody thinks they know because they read something about someone else who thinks they know, explaining existence or something. And yet, who has really actually looked directly at it themselves, really looked at it? Very, very rare that anyone does that. Almost everything in this world you get is just somebody either inventing something or secondhand knowledge or passing on. They don't really know. They haven't looked. Not looked at all. We just don't look. We say, I'll let somebody else look and then tell me. You've got to look yourself or else there's no conviction. There's no conviction. Without conviction, you can't have choice. You can't exercise choice without conviction. Because it would just be a whim. And you know that you used a whim one time, which is a whim of trying to be prime creator. That was a whim. And so you don't want to ever do whim again. No way. So in order to make a choice, you have to have conviction right now. You have to. And without contemplation, you won't have conviction. Without conviction, you won't exercise your choice. So you really have no choice but to contemplate. You don't. Nobody is going to choose a new idea on a whim because they've been burned so badly by a whim already. So they say, no. I need conviction. Everyone will admit to that in this world. They say, no, I need conviction. But how do you get it? Do you get it by reading something that someone else said? No, you don't. That might motivate you, but you still have to look. You have to look directly at existence. You have to look at it. You have to see it. See what it is. See what's going on. See what's always been taking place. See what the dynamics really are. It's a sacrificial belief system. Existence. You have to see it for yourself. And it's like, so. And once you see it, then it's like, wow. Now I see. Now I have some conviction. And then I can move closer to choice. The more conviction you have, the more closer you can get to making the choice. The less conviction, the farther away you are. And you can't get conviction unless you yourself take a look. You know, it's like you have your eyes closed, you know. And your eyes are covered. And somebody else is explaining what's out there. Now, are you going to then walk along or run based on somebody else just telling you what's there? Well, you might say, well, okay, if I trust the person, fine. Yeah, but because we chose on a whim the idea of trying to be prime creator, we've been so badly burned by this idea that we're not willing to take anyone's word for it. Not willing. There's no willingness there to do that. So the thing is, you have to uncover your eyes and see, or else you will not run. You will not make another choice. You will stick with what you have because you figure, if I choose on a whim again, it could be even worse than this. It could be even worse. So nobody is going to choose a new idea on a whim. Nobody's going to do it. That's kind of why I you know, you've heard in other videos that I don't know how to say it, but I'm not comfortable with the kind of teaching that's presented, even by really good teachers who say, just come on in, the water's fine, don't worry, just jump in. It's not going to happen. It doesn't happen. And then you wonder, you ask these gurus, well, how many devotees have you sent out to teach who have got it? And they say, well, no one. A lot of teachers say, not a single one. Duh. Why? Because they were just saying, jump in. Nobody's going to jump in. Because it's there's not enough conviction. It's still whim to them. And the threat of whim, our experience with whim has been a catastrophic, utterly catastrophic one. So there's no way. He's not going to do it. The safe way is to contemplate and get conviction, tremendous conviction. And then you can say, ah, okay, I trusted enough to make them choose a new idea. It's not a whim anymore, you know. Otherwise, you might get super rare instance where somebody will jump in, super rare. But as far as a general plan, the whole way of teaching, I'm just saying, jump, come on in, the water's fine. It doesn't work. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. It's only going to have a few rare instances of success. Sometimes those teachers who teach that way, they themselves were a rare instance, a very rare instance, where they somehow were able to trust enough that they jumped and chose a new idea. And then they then assume that other people can do the same thing. And they don't quite understand that they were extremely rare instance of that. In my case, in contemplation, I know there's something everybody can do. Everybody will eventually do it. So it will not be a rare instance at all. When I make the choose a new idea, it's not a rarity at all. I can say with a certainty that contemplation is the way. Inquiry is the way. Sustained inquiry, a life of inquiry, is the way. That's the safe way. And you will gain conviction through that, through doing that. And that conviction will then tilt things away from the belief in whim, you know, to belief in certitude. It will no longer seem like a whim to you. And that's absolutely crucial, because we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator on a whim. Just a crazy whim, like, just for the heck of it, let's just do something nuts, let's just choose this idea. Bad idea, you know. That's the one idea you don't want to choose, you didn't want to choose, and we did it on just a crazy whim. So now we are utterly terrified of choosing again on a whim. We want to know for sure. Now, perfect certitude is impossible prior to choosing it. You cannot conceptually, from the standpoint of belief and conception, concepts, you cannot have perfect certitude. So you can never completely erase the fear of a whim. You cannot completely erase it. It's not possible. So if anyone would come to me and say, how do I do it, you know? How do I jump? Just jump. Cannot jump into it. You cannot do it. Unless you're like some totally rare freak exception, you know. It would just be a complete freak exception. 99.99999999999% of everyone will do it by contemplation, will do it by gaining certitude or gaining conviction over a period of time. We'll do it gradually, gain conviction, more and more and more conviction. They'll do it that way. That's why big religions are helpful, and they set up vocations, monastic vocations. That's helpful. That's very helpful. It's not a bad thing at all. That way you can have millions and millions of people go through lifetimes of contemplation, which is extremely helpful. Whereas if you just have one guru who's a freak exception, and they jumped in and they're teaching others, come on, jump, 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 don't worry, I'm here, I'll catch you, go ahead and jump, jump, jump. And maybe they get one person in a lifetime jumps, that you know, that is not much compared to millions of people taking a monastic vocation of a life of contemplation. Millions and millions. That's real significant. Very significant. Very, very significant. Which is why Ananda Mahima supported the entire monastic structure of India and the world all the vocations. Very important. She made a point of always giving deference to those who were in vocations, always. They had the greatest attention and support, because her purpose was to support the entire structure of vocation, religious vocation, contemplative vocation in India, in the world. That was her purpose, really. One of the, you know, cornerstones of her purpose here, because that is super crucial. Super crucial. When that decays, when that falls apart, then you have real trouble here in the world. And you have people thinking that the gurus will say, jump, 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 are the only way to go about it, you know? And it's not true. It is not true. They have their place. They have their place. They can be helpful, sure. But there's more to it than that. There's more to it. You need a culture that supports vocations, contemplative vocations. And Anamaya Ma supported that culture. She tried to keep it going, you know. I don't know how successful that was. I can't really judge that. But I my feeling is that that whole vocational system in India has been under attack and being undermined, severely undermined. It used to be that all the renunciates could ride trains for free. Now I don't think that's the case. And of course, they could stay anywhere for free. The whole thing is now being turned into economic kind of warfare against that whole vocational system, religious vocational contemplative system, as being attacked and undermined and diminished in many, many, many different ways. Very bad thing to take place. Same thing in Christianity. Same thing. Again, vocations are seen as something totally passé, even in Ireland. How can you believe that? Somebody told you 50 years ago there would be, you know, one vocation in Ireland in a whole year or something. You would have said they're completely insane. That's utterly impossible. Yet it happened, you see. That shows you to the extent to which the whole worldwide system of contemplative vocation has been undermined. It's done purposefully. That undermining has been intentionally carried out. That's how existence works. That's what it does. It tries to sustain itself at all costs. At all costs. Existence will do anything to sustain itself and to distract away from choosing a new idea, which is what contemplative vocations are aimed towards. That's the goal. So existence will do everything it can to undermine the contemplative vocations on this planet and everywhere in the universe, whatever it can do. And it can do, you know, anything it wants to do. It will come up with all sorts of stuff. Distractions and... There's been a great war on this planet. People don't realize it. It's a war against contemplative vocations to break that momentum in that direction. And that's really been the intense war on this planet. Very intense, to undermine that, you know, by pointing out the foibles of religions, which there are many, of course. I mean, even their theology's messed. Everything's messed up theologically. And however, the cornerstone is contemplative vocations. That is super important. And that, you know, is not messed up, because that's opportunity. Giving opportunity is not messed up. Now, what you make of it is one thing, but giving the opportunity is another thing. And that's super important. And there's been an effort to try and diminish that across the board. It's been very successful. Very successful. You know, the smart people of the world, what they try to get advanced, high degrees in the best universities, get the best jobs, make the most money, all that stuff. They're not thinking about sitting in a cave for 30 years. You know, nobody thinks about that. If you do, the whole world will say you're absolutely nuts, you're an idiot. It used to be that the best and the brightest would do that, because that's the highest vocation in the world, the highest. Not some college degree. The contemplatives was the highest vocation on the planet. So the very best would do that. You get people like Shankara coming in the world, supporting the whole, you know, the whole system. You get all these great sages coming in the world and supporting it, saying that, you know, and building it up over thousands of years. The saints, the sages, the avatars, the gurus, all these realized beings would build up this whole vocational contemplative setup, because it's what works. It's what works. And now that's all been torn down. It's being torn down and leveled by existence, which is what existence does. So contemplation is not an end in itself, because the opportunity can be lost. It can be torn down. You have to succeed at it. The journey is not the point. It's the goal that's the point there. You have to succeed. You have to choose a new idea. Otherwise, you know, the opportunity gets snatched away at some point. Everything in this world is variable, keeps changing. And opportunity doesn't last forever here, as we have seen. As we have seen. And, you know, the question is, can it be reestablished right now on this planet? Yeah. I don't think so. I really don't. I don't think it will be. But you never know. You never say never, because everything in existence changes. So at some point, other opportunities will arise. That's inevitable too. But right now, it is not looking good at all. The trend is definitely away from that. And, you know, at some point with the problems that will arise in the world, people will want to turn towards that. And at some place in time and space, they will. They'll get into it. They'll say, hey, you know, I don't want to waste another life. Don't want to. And you'll have other great avatars and sages, saints, saviors, etc., come to other places in the universe, and where there's a lot of entities, and set up religious systems, set up systems of contemplation in those places. And then you will, you know, at some point you'll get into it. At some point you'll get into it. And it's important to stick with it and push it through intensely. Don't fool around. The universe is a very place where very variable, and opportunity vanishes very quickly. And unexpectedly. And you think you can hold on to it. You know, it's amazing the leverage that happens in this world. Looking at it, you see how existence works. The kind of leverage it can employ to bring down these institutions is just amazing. Just amazing. Trivial stuff. And yet this stuff is imbued with such importance and meaning for people. It's amazing. They think, oh yeah, we have to dismantle this whole thing because somebody, you know, got a hangnail or something. Somebody got irritated, and so let's just destroy it all. Let's get rid of it all. That's like saying, like, one person had an accident in a car, and therefore we should get rid of all cars. It's that kind of illogic that is at work in the world, because the purpose is to get rid of contemplation entirely. And so any excuse is a good excuse. Doesn't matter what the excuse is. Doesn't matter. Someone can say, well, I woke up today and I felt like I didn't want it and it bothers me, so let's get rid of all of it. And people say, oh, it bothered you? Oh, okay, well, let's get rid of all of it. That's good enough reason. Any reason, any expedient is good enough to get, you know, to justify. In other words, the end justifies the means. So any means, any excuse is good enough in this world now. Doesn't matter. So people are not evaluating from the standpoint of wisdom at all anymore here. I don't see it at all. It's vanished. As simply as, how do we reach the goal as fast as possible by whatever means possible? Whatever works is good enough. Let's call it good. If it works, we'll call it good. You know, they want to get rid of contemplation. Absolutely want to get rid of it. Entirely rid of it, because that's the vulnerability. Okay, that's the vulnerability of existence. Contemplation is the kryptonite to existence. It's the Achilles heel of existence. It's the vulnerability of existence, because you can see that you have the power of choice over existence. You can choose some other scenario, some other idea other than existence. You have the power to do that, and existence knows that. Existence fears you. Doesn't want you to know you have that power. Wants to keep you in the dark about that. Wants to keep you totally in the dark. I keep looking at, I see my on the screen, and I want to sing a song by George Jones because I look so much like him. It's hilarious. Oh my gosh. But I won't do it. My singing days are over. Actually, I sang in church today. I sang very well. Sang maybe as good as I've ever sung. Of course, in church, nobody can hear you sing. So it doesn't really matter, you know. So, you know, you can sing great. I improvise, too. We have these very solemn songs. You know, this is the way you sing them. You know, this, nobody, the choir leaders, nobody deviates. You know, everyone's right on the note. You know, there's some, they do some harmony and stuff, which is good. I mean, we have super talented band there. Very talented, very good. And when I sing, I'm using counterpoint and shifting octaves and embellishing this and doing all sorts of intricate stuff. Hitting the first syllable crisply and then rolling off the end of each word, you know, into the next word, and creating different transitions from line to line and phrase to phrase, and popping in all sorts of accents and all, just doing all sorts of complex stuff. And yet nobody can hear what I'm doing at all because, you know, collectively everybody's singing. So it's funny. I guess you're not supposed to do that. I don't know. Nobody can hear it anyway, so it doesn't really matter. So it's fun. It's, they can practice, you know, doing stuff with other people singing where you just, like I do a fifth or a fourth or, you know, change, harmonize in different intervals and try to do that and practice doing that. I used to practice singing where the whole song, I never sang the notes that the singer was singing, always something different, just harmonizing in different ways completely. That's, I did that for years, just practicing doing that. It's fun. It's a blast. It's a blast. Don't just sing what someone's singing. Don't just sing the same notes. See if you can sing, you know, harmonize in different ways. That's just, that's fun. But I'm not going to sing here. No, this is serious business. Besides, what fun is it? You know, it's funner to harmonize with someone, you know, else than just singing solo. That's not much, that much fun, really. It was a great night tonight. Perfect night. Crickets. You know, it's warm and yet it's crisp. There's some light from the moon. It's just like an awesome evening. Awesome evening. So I don't even feel like stopping. Autumn is a great time of year. This autumn is going to be pretty doggone intense for the world. We're facing some real situations coming up. So, again, you have to find a way to contemplate during these times, which is why I'm giving you this, you know, 2-3 hours here, just to kind of hang out together. That's all I'm doing, hanging out, talking, chatting, and just sharing perspectives and giving you a chance to tune into this pacing, tune into this focus, practice it, and realize it's different than what's available in the world. Mostly it's different focus. You have a different focus. You're able to focus. You're able to do this. Then, you know, say, ah, I've got an ace up my sleeve. When all this stuff starts coming down, you know, and it will, you've got an ace up your sleeve, and you can just shift into contemplation, shift into this, just drop the focus on the rest of it. You know, during these 3 hours, I've not been focusing on the world so much. Just more, it's an overview, a total picture. Don't look at the frame, look at the picture. All this fashion stuff is just the frame, not the picture. We distract ourselves by looking at the frame around the picture, and we don't never look at the picture. You have to look at the picture. And so when all this stuff starts happening, that's the frame. Everything's happening in the frame. The picture remains the same. Existence remains the same. Same purpose, same agenda, same dynamics, same everything. It's all exactly the same. The picture hasn't changed at all. But the frame is always changing, always changing, always changing. And so our attention is distracted onto the frame, trying to figure out what's going on with the frame. What we need to do is shift our attention onto the picture. Look at the picture. And we gradually see the picture never changes. The same thing. Existence has always been the same. There's never been any change in existence. Nothing has changed here. The more things change, the more they stay the same in existence. Impermanence is impermanence. Change is change. Energy is energy. All this stuff, cycling is cycling. Everything that happens is always been happening. Decay, death has, you know, always been happening. Decay, impermanence, instability, change, 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 change. That's all the same. That's the picture. It's always all the same. The attempt to transmute the hypothetical into the real is all the same. Sacrifice, all the same. So the underlying dynamics, the picture, is the same. The frame is just a distraction. New clothes, new hairstyle. I remember, what was it, like the late 50s, early 60s, Christian Dior with the crinoline, you know, the dresses, all crinolines were back in. Whereas before, those were completely out of style. Now suddenly, you know, the petticoats or crinoline, whatever they call them, were all back in style, and all of these were so stylish with their, you know, the new look. It was called the new look, Christian Dior, the new look. And of course, it was recycling an old look, and it lasted for a few years, and then kaboom, haven't seen it since. It'll come back. Oh, it keeps recycling. Fashion recycles in different ways. And it's the frame. It's just the frame distracting us. Thinking, hey, this is new. This is different. This is interesting. Let me follow this. Instead of looking at the picture, what is existence really? It's a sacrificial belief system. It's a hypothetical scenario. It arises from the idea of wanting to be prime creator. Okay? And it's an attempt to construct through process a new power of destructivity, a power of destructivity over reality that can then force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. That is what the picture really is. And it's impossible. That's also the picture. It's futile. It's impossible. It's a waste of time. It's meaningless. Will never happen. And how do we solve it? By choosing a different idea. The idea of not trying to change reality, not trying to be prime creator. Choose that and you get the experience of unconditional love, equal distribution everywhere. No oscillation, no instability, perfect stability, unchanging stability everywhere. You get that experience and that gives off the fragrance of remembrance of reality for you. That's the picture. That's the picture. That's the remedial picture. You have the one picture of this trying to change reality, trying to be part, and then another picture of not trying to change reality. So as you get skilled at looking at the picture, you can look at both pictures. There's two pictures. You get to choose one or the other. And you get skilled at looking at the picture, and you're seeing what the picture really is instead of just the frame. Instead of just the frame, which is always, you know, at least in existence, the frame is always changing. Whereas in the idea of not trying to change reality, the frame doesn't change. The picture and the frame are one there. But you still have to look at the picture to get certitude, to get this feeling of conviction. Again, can't do it on whim. Can't do it on whim. So again, I emphasize to all of you, you have to put in the time. Don't think you can skimp. You know, you can't become a virtuoso if you don't practice, believe me. If you want to, you know, be virtuoso, you practice 10 hours a day, minimum. So, contemplation, you don't necessarily have to put in 10 hours a day, but you can. I used to put in more than that every day, like 14 to 18 hours a day. But, you know, you can put in whatever you can put in, do it, because you're going towards conviction. You need conviction. You need it. Don't trust whim. Don't trust it. You won't trust it. I mean, you won't do it on a whim. You won't jump on a whim. You won't do it. You will not do it. Only the rarest of rare freakish occurrences does that happen, where you just say, well, I have no conviction, really, but you know what, it just seems right, so I'm just going to do it. I mean, just, I'm like, boom, I did it, you know. Don't trust, don't believe, don't put your destiny in that belief. That's a lazy person. A lazy person says, ah, I'm just going to do it on a whim sometime. I don't need any conviction at all. So I don't need to spend any time in contemplation. I can live life. I live a fashionable life. I can, you know, be hip and cool and trendy and rich and do all the stuff I want to do. And it's a great life. And, you know, and then on a whim, I'll choose a new idea. That's a bad plan. That's a plan of failure. You should say, I really doubt that I'm going to be this freakish, rare exception. So if I am, fine, but I haven't found it yet, and if I was, I probably already done it. So let me contemplate, inquire until I get this certitude. Not 100%, but conviction. Get this conviction, more and more conviction. Yeah, choosing a new idea. That's the right thing to do. It's a safe thing. It's non-traumatic, and on and on and on, you know. And then you get more and more a conviction so that you can actually do it at some point. That's the safe way. That's the way that works. And you always want to do the way that works instead of trying to be a show off and say, let me try to do the be one of out of one in 100 billion who actually do it on a whim kind of thing. Why, that's just a desire for specialness right there anyway, really, you know. I want to be special. I want to be superior. I want to be better. So let me be the one who's the rare exception. Now, forget it. That spiritual pride. You know, if you're going to do it that way, you're going to do it that way. But, you know, you're not going to do it that way. People are not going to do it that way. So put in the time. Put in the time. Put in the effort. You know, that is the teaching. Put in the time. Put in the effort. There's no better teaching than that. That's the ultimate teaching. Put in the time. Put in the effort. As a mantra, put in the time, put in the effort. Ananda, my mom, always asked people, how much time are you putting in, how much effort? And whatever they told her, she said, put in a little more. That was her basic teaching. She didn't really give much teaching at all, really. Really did not give teaching out. She just went around to everybody and she'd ask them, how much time are you putting in, how much effort? And she said, okay. She said, for my sake, can you give a little more time and increase it? That's it. That's it. That's the ultimate teaching, really. Because without time and effort, you're not going to get there. Because you're relying on a whim, and you don't trust whim. You know, theoretically, you can do it on a whim. Practically, you will not. You've been burned too severely to do it that way. So you have to feel conviction. Time. You got to put the time, the effort. You got to do it. Just do it. And nobody's stopping you from doing it. And you, when you do it, you'll feel like you're doing the best thing in the world, really. And you realize other people are just wasting their time, sadly. But by your example, eventually other people will be guided into doing that time, making the effort. So it's beneficial to everybody. Your contemplation is beneficial to everybody in the big picture. It absolutely is. Because someday you will literally be somebody who goes around helping people up their efforts, you know. And because you'll have done it. You'll have done it. You know. You will be the virtuoso. You will be the one who's choosing a new idea. You'll be the one who abides in unconditional love. You will be that one for sure. No doubt about it. You cannot be kept away from it. And when? When you get enough conviction. If you put it on whim, then you ask the question, when? Could be, who knows? You know, could be now, could be a billion years in the future. No way of knowing, right? Because it's on a whim, so how can you know? It's impossible to know if it's on a whim. But if you're doing the contemplation, the inquiry, you can pretty well know for doggone sure that you're going to get it pretty soon. Like for me right now, I feel like I'm for sure I'm going to get it soon, very soon. There's not much left to, you know, the conviction is very strong. Very strong. The fear has been radically diminished. So I know for a fact I will get it soon. I don't know exactly when, but I know very soon. Whereas on a whim, there's no way to say anything. You'd say, well, could be a billion years from now. I don't know. A million years. Could be tomorrow. Could be any time. Who knows? No way of knowing. Terrible position to be in. So you do the work now. And you will get closer and closer and closer, and you will know more and more and more that you're going to succeed. you will see for sure. It's not whim. You're not basing on a whim anymore. Forget the whim. Forget it. And you'll join good company, because you'll join everybody else. And the greatest of all teachers, they come in the world, they say, don't base it on a whim. Do the work. Forget it. You know, forget this notion that you can not pay any attention and then suddenly, boom, just, you know, get it. Just, I met the guru one day and kaboom, that's it. You know, right? Right now. Those people who meet the guru and get it, you know, they've been doing 50 years of contemplation, or, you know, beforehand. And if they get it early in life, they've done 50 years in a previous life. Or even lifetimes of it, you know. But you should be able to do it in one lifetime, definitely. If you take the path of contemplation, you do it right, you should be able to do it in one lifetime. These opportunities are rare, you know, to having this time to do this and putting in the time to put a 3-hour video up. Who knows, you know, how much, how often these kind of opportunities come along. Not very often. So I'm making the most of it. Who knows how stable the world will remain? It's very unstable underneath. It's like the world is like a patient in a hospital on heavy medication. It's like someone in a coma almost, where I know someone that works in a coma center where patients who are in comas are cared for. And there are some patients that have been there 30 years, and they're still in a coma. These are people that they don't expect ever to wake up. And yet they're on all sorts of medications and artificial breathing and this and that. You know, UV feeding, IV feeding, I mean. And, you know, you go in and see them, they say, oh, they're just sleeping. You know, they'll wake up soon. You think they might wake up any time. Nobody knows. They might wake up. The world is kind of like in a coma. You know, it's still going along. Everything seems to be going along. But there's something that's like missing, you know. There's something about the world that's really missing right now. And you know it. You can feel it. Everybody's feeling it. There's something is amiss. Big time amiss. That's very true, which is why everybody's distracting themselves now in whatever way, of whatever type of distraction they feel most comfortable with and most effective. Try not to recognize, you know, look at the picture. Wait a minute, what's wrong with this picture here? Something is really amiss. Red flags are everywhere. It's incredible. Yeah, you just spend your whole, you could spend all your time just pulling up red flags on everything here. And so things will not necessarily remain stagnant and stable and non-consequential and, you know, same old, same old. Nah, transformations are coming within energy. Energy constantly transforming itself as if to try and generate a real power of transformation over reality. Power over reality. Existence is constantly, symbolically, it's all symbolic, transforming itself constantly. Sometimes very severely, rapidly. And so we have this, like, coma patient that's in a coma, and we think, well, the world should awaken from it pretty soon. If we just get, you know, QE3, you know, we're going to awaken from it, you know. You know, doubtful the world is going to awaken from this coma that it's in. I don't believe it will. It's, you know, the signs are there that this is a, this coma is not, we're not going to awaken. We're not going to go back to the kind of awareness and awakeness that we had in the past. It's not going to happen. This is a negative spiral we're in now. So contemplation is your ace up your sleeve. It really is. You have the power of contemplation. What I said, the power of choice, the power of contemplation is another power. If you have that, You have the greatest tool you can possibly have in this world. This world cannot stop your contemplation, cannot stop it. No matter what happens, cannot stop it. You have the power to do it. And ultimately, you have the power to choose a new idea and get free of existence. Experience unconditional love. You have that power. You have that power. And keep your mind in yourself. Keep connecting with it. Keep seeing it. Keep ironing out the reluctance to use this power. We have it, but we're reluctant to use it. And we have to, you know, get rid of that reluctance. Get the conviction that we need, that it's safe, it's not dramatic. You know, I work on this stuff all the time. And real progress comes about. You see, less and less fear of trauma, less and less fear of continuity gap, less fear of being excluded from any new reality, less fear of being, you know, rejected entirely, less fear of this, less fear all the way around. And that gets more and more conviction, which gets closer and closer to choice. And it's that way for everybody. These are the basics. It's that way for everybody. It's a positive spiral. Contemplation puts you into a very positive spiral. Everything feeds and enforces this positive spiral towards choice. It's fantastic, really. Whereas the world is right in negative spiral. Negative spiral down to not choosing. Just continuing to go along with existence, the sacrificial scenario of existence, just saying, well, just going along with it, not refusing to choose a new idea, and all that entails, the suffering that brings with it. It's just that. That's what it is. So these are the options that we're mulling over here. And this is just an example of how you can do it. You can do it. Just put together 3 hours here, just focusing in on it, right? You can do it. It's very doable. We used to have things called rap sessions. R.A.P. Not like modern rap. That's a term from beat musicians, is to rap. Talk sessions. We just sit around free, what do you call it? Stream of consciousness, free association. I'm reaching the limit here. Oh well, I'll just let it happen. Free association, spontaneous, stream of consciousness, rap sessions. Groups of people just hang out and have rap sessions. And we get into stuff. And just ideas. Everyone felt free to contribute their ideas and stuff. It was like a jam session, like a musical jam session. Everybody's playing their instrument, and sometimes you come up with a great groove. We did that all the time. Sit around and have a rap session. I loved it. I loved that. Because then you could bring up stuff, and people would say, "Hey, okay, it's cool." You felt free to bring up whatever. There was no PC at that time. Really, we didn't even know there's no such thing as political correctness at that time. You know, everybody felt they could say whatever they felt like. Nobody was going to be judged by what they said. You know, pro or con, it was okay. It was a rap session. Everything is allowed. Everything is allowed in a rap session. The world misses that, I'm telling you. My God, you know, how helpful that would be for the world, wouldn't it? Everything is allowed. You know, nowadays, someone would record you, put it on Facebook, you'd be reported to the authorities, you said this, you said that, you'd lose your job, you'd be sued, you'd be criminally prosecuted. You know, insanity. You cannot function as a society that way, under the kind of restrictions that society has. People need to be free, feel free to share where they're coming from without fear of losing their freedom or their income. Okay? Absolutely essential. Absolutely essential. And religions had to, confession, where you'd confess, and that's sacred, you know, and you could say anything. It was like we had group confessional, it was rap sessions, and everybody just say, well, I'm coming from here, coming from there, and you could change. You're free to change your position. Nobody's pinning you down, judging you. They ask questions, you know, and it's non-judgmental. It was just fantastic. It was fantastic. And that flavor also, that's something that's very helpful, along with contemplation, is ability to just feel free to share different viewpoints. You might not even agree with the viewpoint, but you say, what about this viewpoint? Let me share this, pro or con this or that, whatever. And it's all good. It's all good. And nobody thinks less of you by saying anything.